So welcome, and I would like to introduce our teacher here at the Dharma Collective, MC Owens. And with that, thank you all for coming. And deep bow and to my teacher.
Thanks, Noe. All right. Welcome back, everybody. So like Noe said, we're waiting for a few people, but we're going to go ahead and get started. So I'll kind of ease us into this primarily by kind of introducing what we're going to talk about today and what we're going to go over. This is my first time teaching publicly in a while, so I am going to have to get used to this versus this. So that's just bear with me on that. So many familiar faces. So you all know me, know the way I teach. But if you don't, first of all, we won't be doing a formal meditation for this workshop. But many of you know that my approach to the Dharma, approach to Buddhism, is that there are many modes of meditation. And the kind of silence seated is one mode. But I also think that studying and reading the sutras and contemplating these ideas is another form of meditation in that way. So I actually don't feel that there isn't a meditation. I actually feel like this is going to be a 3-hour long meditation on a particular idea. And that idea is basically going to be the idea of right view. That's going to be talking about today. That's sort of the topic. But because of the way that I like to teach Buddhism or teach the Dharma, is I always like to teach sutra-based in that way. I think it's just the most direct way to the teachings, in my opinion. As many of you know, I'm kind of trained as a historian and a linguist. So my background is in Chinese language and translation, but I'm familiar with Sanskrit and a little bit of Pali in that case. So my approach to these sutras is a kind of critical approach in that way, where we're really interested in the language, we're really interested in understanding each word, but I'm also not, say, just a scholar or just a historian in that way. I am a practitioner. I like to think I'm a deep practitioner in that sense. And so I want to kind of share with everybody today the practice of studying sutras, not just sort of this academic exercise in that way. So that's sort of just kind of a brief introduction to the approach of today. The other thing too, if you haven't really kind of sat with me or haven't had classes with me, very informal. I like it to be very casual in terms of that. If you have questions or comments, feel free to interrupt me. I actually like to be interrupted in that way because I don't like to move further ahead if anybody's sort of left behind in that way and still like wondering about something I just said. So please like stop. Can we go back to whatever it is? And I'm happy to go back in that way. With those preliminary remarks, Noam probably gave you a sheet. It's basically consists of two things. One is a translation of the sutra that we'll be reading and my sort of outline for the class. I've divided the class into three kind of movements. Depending on how quickly these movements happen, we might take a break after the first movement and a break after the second, or not. So I'm going to play the breaks by ear. But like Noe was saying at the beginning, bathroom's down the hall. Again, part of the informality is that if you need to stretch, if you need to leave, if you need to go to the bathroom, please just do it. There's no offense taken over here. So, all right. So let's take a look at this. So this is my sort of outline where we're going to spend the first part of today really just looking at the text. So we're going to look at the sutra. I'm going to recite the sutra. And we're going to just sort of really examine the text. But then we're going to take a moment in the second movement, and we're going to move a little bit outside of that and get more into the philosophy of it. So that's where we'll get kind of deeper into the Dharma in that sense. And then the third movement we're going to spend on this idea of dependent origination, which occurs in the text. But I want to tell you actually It's part of my new approach to teaching is not keeping surprises. I try to be a little theatrical in my teaching. So I sometimes keep surprises, but I've realized that's not actually the best way to teach. So I want you to know that what we're doing today is we're going to look at this sutra sort of from three directions in a way. And what I mean by that is, and first of all, I'd like to thank Noe. Noe brought this sutra to my attention. Despite what a lot of people think, I haven't read every sutra in existence or anything like that. I'm actually still making my way through the Pali canon in that way. So I thank you, Noe, for bringing this to my attention. Noe said, hey, there's this great sutra in the Saṃyutta Nikāya. Like, why don't you maybe do a talk on it? And I thought, why don't I do a whole 3-hour class on it? So what's so exciting about this sutra is that, and by the way, if there's anybody that doesn't know a lot of the history, don't worry, we're going to back up and kind of go deeper into that. So if you don't know what this book is, you will in a second. So this sutra, of course, is at least the version in here is being translated from the Pali language, which is, of course, considered the kind of original language of the Buddha, the original language of Buddhism. That, of course, is debatable in that sense. I'm not here to argue it one way or another. I just want you to know that it's not entirely agreed upon that Pali is the language that the Buddha spoke. But no one will argue that it's not a very old language and that these sutras are very old in that sense. So this sutra is part of what is called the Saṃyutta Nikāya, the connected discourses of the Buddha. And you might be familiar with this as part of a series of books that are called the Nikayas, the collections. And these are all of the gathered teachings of the Buddha that exist in the Pali language. Again, considered the oldest. But what's interesting about this sutra is that this sutra, this tiny little, not even a whole page of a text, it actually becomes the foundation for the teachings of Nagarjuna, who is, of course, the founder of a school of Buddhism called the Madhyamaka. And the Madhyamaka, those teachings of this philosopher Nagarjuna, are the foundation of what is called Mahayana Buddhism. So there's an interesting way in which the entirety of Mahayana Buddhist philosophy comes out of this Pali Sutra. And then what's even more interesting, we're going to talk about this at the end, is that in a sutra like the Lankavatara Sutra, which is considered one of the kind of earlier sutras, the more recent sutras, this sutra is one that comes from what would be called the third turning of the Dharma wheel. Also, this is a foundational text for Yogacara Buddhism, mind-only Buddhism, as it might be called. And so this is actually a very late development in Buddhism. And if you know your structure of the three turnings of the Dharma wheel, this is considered the first turning, the original Pali teachings. The Madhyamaka and Mahayana is considered the second turning. And a sutra like this is considered part of the third turning. So it's, and this sutra quotes the sutra that we're going to be reading today as well. So fascinating that this particular little sutra finds its way into all three turnings of the Dharma wheel.
Michael, yeah. What's the name of that third turning, the one that you got here?
The Lankavatara Sutra.
Lankavatara?
Lanka, as in Sri Lanka, the beautiful Lanka, the little, what used to be called Ceylon, the little island. And the Vatara is a castle. So this is the castle on Mount Lanka. And by the way, this we will talk about this in the third portion. So if there's more questions about that, we'll talk about it then. All right, so that's why I was so curious about this sutra, is the way that it makes its way into all of these different versions of Buddhism. And this is another thing that many of you already know about me. I don't come from any particular lineage of Buddhism. I'm not a Theravada Buddhist. I'm not a Zen Buddhist. I'm not a Tibetan Buddhist. I'm not any of those. And so my teaching is a little unique in that way, because I don't feel like I have a vested interest in any particular school besides The Dharma. I'm into the Dharma in that way. And so for me, I don't draw distinctions between like early Buddhism, middle period, late Buddhism. It's all Buddhism to me. And that's sometimes a difficult case to make. It's a difficult argument to make. There's some people that really feel like the early teachings are the real teachings, the pure teachings, and all of this Mahayana Bodhisattva stuff is a bunch of later invention. But I see a continuity through the Dharma from the very first teaching, the Dharmacakkappavattana Sutra, the turning the Dharma wheel, all the way through to the Zen tradition and beyond. I see a continuity, and this sutra is a great way to make that case for the continuity of the Dharma. So, all right, any questions so far about what's going on here, what we're going to do? Cool. So the first thing that I want to do is read the sutra in its entirety, and then we're going to start going through it word by word, all right? I will, however, begin by making a comment about the title, because it is customary to do that, and I'd like you all to know a little bit about where the sutra is coming from. So the sutra, as it's called in the Saṃyutta Nikāya, is the Kaccānagotta Sutta. And Kaccānagotta is the name of a person, all right? This is one of the 10 chief disciples of the Buddha. You might be familiar with that idea that the Buddha had these 10 senior disciples, such as Shariputra, Madhyayana, Upali, Ananda. And each of these 10 disciples were considered the foremost in, and then someone like Madhyayana was considered the foremost in meditation, the foremost in the accomplishments of meditation. Shariputra is sort of known for being the foremost in knowledge of the Abhidharma, the sort of the deeper philosophy of the Dharma in that way. Another surprise that I'm not going to keep till the end, Kaccāyana, which is also, he's just known as Kaccāyana, Gotra means like of the family of Kaccāyana. So Kaccāyana, interestingly, is considered the foremost in explaining short discourses of the Buddha. And I didn't learn that until I had already planned doing a 3-hour long class on this tiny little sutra. And then I learned that that's what Kaccāyana, which is the way you say the name in Sanskrit, I learned, oh, that's what he's all about. How interesting. So we love dharmanicities like that, right? Okay, so that's who this is. And I just wanted you to know that this is one of the 10 chief disciples. He's known for explaining short discourses. And so here's what happened. At Shravasti or Savati, then the venerable Kaccānagotta approached the Blessed One, paid homage to him, sat down to one side, and said to him, "Venerable, it is said, right view. Right view. In what way, venerable sir, is there right view?" The Buddha said, "This world, Kaccāyana, for the most part, depends upon a duality, upon the notion of existence and the notion of non-existence. But for one who sees the origin of the world as it really is, with correct wisdom, there is no notion of non-existence in regard to the world. And for one who sees the cessation of the world as it really is, with correct wisdom, there is no notion of existence in regard to the world. This world, Kaccāyana, is for the most part shackled by engagement, clinging, and adherence. But this one, the one with right view, does not become engaged and cling through that engagement and clinging, that mental standpoint, adherence, and underlying tendency. They do not take a stand about myself. They have no perplexity or doubt that what arises is only suffering arising. What ceases is only suffering ceasing. One's knowledge about this is independent of others. It is in this way, Kaccāyana, that there is right view. All exists. Kaccāyana, this is one extreme. All does not exist. This is the second extreme. Without veering towards either of these extremes, the Tathagata teaches the Dharma by the middle. With ignorance as a condition, volitional formations come to be. With volitional formations as a condition, consciousness, and so on. Such is the origin of this whole mass of suffering. But with the remainderless fading away and cessation of ignorance comes cessation of volitional formations. With the cessation of volitional formations, cessation of consciousness, and so on. Such is the cessation of this whole mass of suffering. All right, so that's the sutra, short and to the point. So let's begin with, actually, now that we are familiar with the sutra, I want to tell you a little bit more about it in a way, just to kind of solidify a certain point I want to make. So this is where we're going, this might be a little academic for everyone, but don't worry, it won't last long, I promise. So I started a moment ago by mentioning that a lot of people, scholars, what have you, really hold on to the idea that the Pali language is this original language of Buddhism or the Buddha. And then there's this sense in which, therefore, if it's in Pali, it's sort of the best. And what I would like you to know, and this will be important as we move forward, there are actually several versions of this sutra. And in particular, as my notes kind of state in the beginning, we basically have a Pali version of this sutra, actually a few different Pali version or editions of this sutra. We have a Chinese version of this sutra, and we have a Sanskrit version of this sutra. Now, really quickly, the Sanskrit version actually was recently discovered, or fairly recently discovered. So up until recently, we didn't even know there was a Sanskrit version. We assumed there was because the Chinese version was translated from a Sanskrit version. So the Sanskrit one is a little late. It's from about the 11th or 12th century. Yeah, so it's a little late. So what I really want to talk about quickly is the Chinese version of this sutra. So what a lot of people don't know, and I kind of like to let everybody know this. So as you may or may not know, the Chinese are meticulous historical record keepers and have been for a very, very, very long time. And what that means is that starting in around the year 150 or 160, but a long time ago, the Chinese Buddhists, or even in many ways just the Chinese that weren't necessarily Buddhist, began this translation project, a grand translation project of translating Buddhist texts and Buddhist ideas that were coming through the Central Asia, like along what you might know of as the Silk Road. So these sutras were all coming into China from India in the Sanskrit language or a Sanskrit-related language, something like Gandhari. There's a lot of languages from Central Asia that are very kind of related to Sanskrit in that way. But anyways, they're all coming into China beginning in the second century AD. So this is a long time ago. And so what happens is that a sutra like this, which would have been known as the Kaccāyana Sutra, because again, that's the name of this monk in Sanskrit. The Kaccāyana Sutra was translated into Chinese, let's see what I have. Yeah, in the early 400s, the early 400s, like 400 AD, I can't stress this enough, like from a historical point of view, how wild that is. In terms of, because historical records, if you don't know, are actually very, very hard to come by in that far back. You get into like the, you know, 1100s, 1200s, 1300s, forget about it. There's piles and piles and piles of historical records. But when you go back that far, there's actually not a lot to go on. So it's kind of amazing that we do have a Chinese version of this sutra from the fifth century that was translated from a Sanskrit version, but we don't actually know what that was. And this version, and this is where things get tricky. That version is in some ways much older than the Pali version. I know, right? And you're like, but how could that be? If the Buddha spoke Pali, then, you know, how could that be? And the thing about it is that this is just where we get into a conundrum of what do we take as authoritative in a certain way? Like, what is considered the most authoritative? And so what you may not know is that there's probably somewhere a palm, a piece of bark, or a palm, a dried palm leaf, and a collection of palm leaves folded into an accordion, like a kind of accordion style sheet, that has a version of this sutra. And this is what's really tricky is that this sutra is written in, it could be written in a number of different scripts. Could be written in Thai, like the Thai from Thailand, the Thai script. It could be written in a number of different scripts, by which we mean the way that the phonetic letters are shaped, right? But if you read the phonetic of that script, you realize, oh, this language isn't Thai. This language isn't Laotian. This language isn't Cambodian. This language is Pali. What a lot of Buddhist students don't kind of know or fully understand is that Pali is a language. It's not a script. It doesn't have a script, actually. It's a language that can be written in English, meaning English letters, but if you were to sound out the words, you wouldn't know what they mean. But if you spoke Pali, like if somebody spoke Pali and they were in the room and you were reading aloud something that was written in quote English letters, but had the phonetic quality of Pali, the Pali speaker would hear you loud and clear, but they wouldn't be able to read it necessarily if they don't know the English letter system, right? So what I'm getting at is that these Pali records that we have are actually very new. Except what they are recording goes all the way back to the Buddha. So in other words, we don't have any material substance, any manuscript or anything from the time of the Buddha, far, far from it. So if you wanted to know what is the earliest like actual record that we have of this sutra, it's this Chinese version from the fifth century. So this is, again, where it's like, well, which is more important, the Pali language or the kind of historical dating? And the thing about it is that the version that was translated into Chinese is probably closer to whatever original version there ever was than the Pali one, because the Pali one has come through a kind of telephone game of history where it's been probably shifted a little bit and shifted a little bit and all of that. So I just want to share with everybody that we actually have a few different approaches and ways to understand this sutra. And I just wanted to share with you all that is sort of why we can study this sutra, not just as a Theravada sutra, not just as a Mahayana sutra, not just as a Vajrayana sutra, even we can study it in all those ways. So, yeah, please.
The context of like the Chinese writing it down from whatever they, I guess, Sanskrit.
Yep.
Like was like just, hey, we got this thing and it seemed totally, we should write it down, or they're like,
oh,
they're in a school and they're like.
Mm-hmm. Excellent question, Brendan. So what you need to know is that the Chinese Buddhists in, say, the 5th century, when this was being translated into Chinese, and by the way, in case anybody is listening or anybody knows, there's a particular Buddhist monk named Gunabhadra. And Gunabhadra, who was alive during the 400s in China, had a very large translation project. And what I mean is he actually had a huge team of translators working with him, and they were involved in a major translation project of translating the Nikayas, these early collections of the Buddhist teachings. By the way, you should know the word Nikaya is a Pali term that's used in that language. They are also known as the agamas or agamas, just to let you know. My point is, Brendan, that the Chinese Buddhists already knew about the agamas, the Nikayas. But what they understood was, oh yeah, those are the old teachings of the Buddha. Those were the teachings that he gave to everybody to warm them up. And you have to understand that that is sort of the Mahayana understanding of the early Buddhist sutras. Like, why doesn't the Buddha just tell them about the emptiness? Why doesn't the Buddha just tell them about all of the real Dharma? That's what the Mahayana people are saying. And the teachings is like, oh, this was all to prepare everybody for the real Dharma that you would find in the Mahayana. And so what that means is that the Chinese were much more interested in translating the Lotus Sutra, Vimalakirti Sutra, Avatamsaka Sutra, all of these major Mahayana texts. That was top priority in China, was to translate the real sutras. That project began not under Gunabhadra. Again, that's the project that began in the 2nd century, translating the important sutras. Fast forward to 300 years, Gunabhadra's on the scene, and he's like, hey, why don't we translate the old stuff too? So they already knew that this stuff existed. So they started either gathering, or they had already had Sanskrit versions of all these old sutras. And so Gunabhadra's like, well, let's get to work and translate them. And so you should know, by the way, that there are complete Chinese versions of all of the Nikayas. And if you are, you know, very serious about Dharma study, it behooves you to actually learn both languages to do cross-referencing, but it's neither here nor there. Yeah. Okay. So there you go. That's a little more background. Now let's start to dive into the text itself. All right. We've covered the title. Whenever you study sutras or teach sutras, there's a format to that, and I like to preserve that format. You always begin with the title, explaining the title. So I did. The title is the name of this monk who asked the question. And by the way, most of the sutras that are in the Saṃyutta Nikāya, they don't even have titles. They are provisionally titled whatever monk asked the question or whatever city they happen to be in. So these aren't official titles. Next up, oh, by the way, too, you might have noticed, or you might already be aware, the Saṃyutta Nikāya, this particular collection, it seems to be, I don't know for sure, but it seems to be a sort of miscellaneous category. And what I mean is that if you read the Digha Nikāya, the long discourses of the Buddha, or the Majjhima Nikāya, the middle length discourses of the Buddha, those are considered, you know, the holy teaching. I mean, it's all considered the holy teachings, but those sutras are considered, like, you got to read those, the greatest hits, as I kind of often say. And so those sutras that are in the Digha Nikāya, Majjhima Nikāya, they have the full, thus have I heard, one time the Buddha was staying in such and such a place with so many monks and so many nuns, and at that time, such and such a person asked this question. When you get to the miscellaneous category of sutras in this book, you get Kaccānagotta. And then this happened. So odds are a sutra like this, if it became popular enough, and by the way, the Chinese version does have the thus have I heard one time the Buddha was staying in such and such place. So the idea is that a sutra like this might have been elevated to a higher status in the early tradition, and then it would have been given an appropriate thus have I heard one time the Buddha and so on. So the brevity of the introduction of this sutra is because it's coming from this miscellaneous category. A quick word about Shravasti. So this sutra takes place in Shravasti. We might presume that it's taking place at the Anathapindika Park in the Jetta Grove. That's a classic place for sutras to take place. But another thing that I like to share with everybody, if you haven't heard this from me already, before all of these sutras were written down, for the few first probably, if this is all debatable too, but it would seem that for the first 100 to 200 years of Buddhist history, it was an oral tradition. If you don't know, also, all sutras are in poetic form in their original languages, whether it be Pali, Sanskrit, or Chinese to a certain degree. So they're all actually poems with a meter measured out in stanzas and all of that. And so in the first few hundred years when Buddhism was an oral tradition, you would have reciters, certain monks or nuns who were good at memorizing the sutras, and then were kind of, that was their role in the Sangha, was to be a reciter, like kind of like a cantor in the Jewish tradition, like there's, it's a special calling to be a cantor or to be a reciter. And so you have these reciters that would recite all these sutras. Well, so fascinating that fairly recently scholars discovered a little manual that was a manual for reciter monks. And what the manual says is that if at any point you can't remember where the sutra took place, it's okay to say that it took place in Shravasti. And what's so funny about that is that before historians discovered this manual, scholars and historians did a survey of the entire early Buddhist canon, and they put together a chronology of the Buddha's entire teaching career. And you know what they discovered? The Buddha taught more times in Shravasti than anywhere else. Or did he? So my whole point is to draw attention to this conspicuous at Shravasti. So let's take that with a grain of salt. At Shravasti, the Venerable Kaccānagotta approached the Buddha, the Blessed One, the Bhagavat, right? Paid homage to him, sat down to one side, and said to him, Venerable Sir, Saṃyutta, or Samadhitti, right view. In what way, Venerable Sir, is there right view? What is right view? So, the question that this whole sutra is resolving is this question of, hey, Buddha, everybody's talking about right view. What is right view? It's a great question. So, as you may know, right view is often considered the first step on the Noble Eightfold Path. But what is right view in terms of the Noble Eightfold Path? Well, the first thing we need to establish is what a drishti is, or a ditti. I cannot pronounce Pali, I can barely pronounce Sanskrit, but this word ditti or drishti is this word that is translated as a view. Now, if you've taken maybe a formal asana yoga class, you might have been instructed to establish your gaze or your drishti. And if you're doing like a pose, your instructor might instruct you to have your gaze or your drishti based on the tip of your finger, if you're doing one of these, or on the tip of your nose, or the point of the wall. So the word drishti does mean a view, a gaze, literally, in that sense. But I like to draw everybody's attention to the fact that in English, we use the word view just like the Pali and Sanskrit word drishti is used. And what I mean is that in English, we would say, like, wow, your house has a great view. It's got a great view. But we also talk about a point of view or a worldview or a political view or a religious view. So we use this English word view, which implies vision and the eyes and seeing, but we use it kind of metaphorically to refer to an opinion. And again, in Pali and Sanskrit, the word functions the same way. It has a literal meaning, but it has this figurative meaning of having a worldview. And that is exactly what a drishti is in Buddhism, not in yoga, but in Buddhism, a worldview. What is a worldview, though? A worldview is complicated to explain, but the basic idea is it's this answer that we all have within ourselves. It's the answer to the question, what's going on here? And let's unpack that a little bit. So about a worldview, one aspect of a worldview is where the world came from. Another idea of a worldview is where the world's headed. Another aspect of the worldview is about oneself and one's place in said world. Ethics and morality might be a part of a worldview in terms of what are our obligations. Do we even have any obligations? And the first thing that I want to make really clear about a view or a drishti is this. Let's take, because it's what the sutra is going to be about, let's take, for example, where did the world come from? Some people believe God created the world. That's an idea. That ex nihilo, out of nothingness, a God creator being created the world. Other people might say, no, it's sort of this this singularity. Yeah, it was a singularity. All matter and all energy was compressed into one point in space and time. And then for some reason, we can't really explain, it exploded. It's what we call the Big Bang. And this explosion of whatever that singularity was is unfolding. And that's where we are now. That's the creation of the world, right? I didn't do the best job of summarizing either of those positions, but I didn't really intend to. Because my point was, is that whether you think God created the world or whether you think it was a chaotic explosion, those are both views. And what we are talking about today is having a view. Whether it's that view, or take your pick. Another view, and this is an interesting one, it's unknowable. It's unknowable what created the world. It's another view. So what we want to start analyzing sort of within our own mind in that way is our own view. And like I said at the beginning, we may probably all have a view, even if it's a kind of agnostic view of uncertainty. That too is a view. What we want to be paying attention to, and now I'm going to kind of open this up a little bit. What we want to be paying attention to is the word that's used in the translation of this sutra. We want to be paying attention to adherence. The word that's used in this text is adherence. And we're talking about the adhering to a view, because ultimately what we're going to be getting around to is more subtle forms of clinging and attachment. And if you know your Dharma, if you know your noble truths, if you know your four noble truths, then you already understand at an intuitive level that there's a kind of a problem with clinging and attachment. And if you really understand your four noble truths, then you know that that's the source of suffering in there, is clinging and attachment. Now, normally, of course, we're talking about clinging and attaching to our wallet, clinging and attaching to our stuff, clinging and attaching to our bodies. But all of those, like, why would you cling and attach to your body? Because you think you're mortal. Why do you think you're mortal? It's part of your worldview. So my point, or the point of the sutra today, is going to be about that there are these manifest surface level aspects of clinging and attachment, again, clinging to objects, things, and this and that. But today we're going to go deeper underneath all of that and look at the very way that we think that then brings about and gives rise to these other more gross, by which I mean overt, forms of attachment. So that's with right view, or at least the word drishti and the idea of having a view. But wait a minute, Buddha, then what is the right view? That's what Kaccāyana wants to know. What is the right view? So for a little bit more background on a view, I mentioned that the establishing right view is considered the first step on the Noble Eightfold Path. It's not always considered the first step. There are different orders of the Eightfold Path, but I'm the type of teacher that sticks with the one where right view is number one. And the reason why that is I want to just spend a brief moment talking about what I consider the first two steps of the Noble Eightfold Path, which is right view, right intention. Right? So samyadrishti, samyak samkalpa, right intention. So this is what I want us to be thinking about as an example. I want us to think about a household where a child is growing up in a household. Yeah. And in that household, they are instilled or taught or given a worldview. And I want to suggest, just as a hypothetical scenario, that in this household, this child is given the worldview that wealth and property lead to happiness and security. Sound familiar? I know that's the household I grew up in. Whether that was explicitly stated or just implicitly stated by what my family considered to be valuable and showed me as valuable, or what TV showed me was valuable, or the movies, what they showed me was valuable, there is a worldview that wealth and property is happiness and security, to the point where even health can be bought in that sense. So there's this idea that I must have money, must have property, because then without them, no happiness, no security. So imagine growing up in a household where that is the worldview, the drishti that's being instilled in them, again, either explicitly or implicitly. Please refrain from judgment. Just notice that that is a worldview, because what we want to pay attention to is the next step on that child's path of life, which is setting the intention to make a lot of money. That intention is in perfect alignment with that worldview. And it's why I want us to refrain from judging that worldview as, you know, whatever, problematic or what have you. Let's be good Buddhists. Let's not judge. Let's just observe and notice, oh yeah, if that's your worldview, then that intention to make a lot of money, it makes perfect sense. Because the more money, the happier, the more secure. Now, we could, and I do in my own teaching, I trace out all eight steps of the Noble Eightfold Path for somebody that's interested in making a lot of money. and what it would mean to even have right mindfulness in that situation, right concentration. But it's actually going to be very different than somebody, say, growing up in a Buddhist household, who's being instructed, say, that maybe attachment to physical objects and obsessing about wealth produces suffering. Oh, the exact opposite. But notice then that that child, instilled with that worldview, would make a very different intention in their life. And they wouldn't make the intention to make a lot of money, because that would seem to be a very bad idea. So again, without judging these, we want to kind of notice from the worldview stems all the rest. Our intentions, what we talk about, what we do, our livelihood, right? All of the steps of the Noble Eightfold Path, or the path of our lives, follow that. And why I'm going kind of through this example is I want us to understand what it might mean to say the right view versus the wrong view. The wrong view from a Buddhist point of view in this case would be the view that property and wealth equal happiness and security. From a Buddhist point of view, it's patently false. It's patently not true in that way. So that would be the wrong view, leading to the wrong intention and so on. Kaccāyana wants to know, what's the right view? Now, I kind of just alluded to it in that way. And I, in many ways, I almost want to retract that idea, that Buddhist idea that, attachment to objects and obsessing about wealth lead to suffering. That is a view. That is a kind of a Buddhist view. But let's step back from that, and let's still be in a state of wonder about what is right view. So, all right, everybody doing okay? Right, amazingly, it's already, 50 minutes gone by. That's great as well. Okay, so then let's take a peek at the next. So the next paragraph, after Kaccāyana asks the question, the Buddha then steps back and says, well, this world, Kaccāyana, for the most part, and there's many a footnote in, if you have this, there's many a footnote. I'm going to paraphrase most of the important ones for you. Oh, and I didn't even introduce the other sheet because I don't have the other sheet. But the other sheet, by the way, is, oh, thanks, Noe, is not my translation, of course, not my work. This is by a scholar named Jayarava. Jayarava is an amazing scholar. He has a website called Visible Mantra. He has a book called Visible Mantra, incredible resource, by the way, for Buddhist studies. He's also a kind of a pan-Buddhist, kind of dabbles in all the languages of Buddhism. So I want you to notice that we have the original Pali text in English letters, as I was saying. I wish I would have remembered this when I was talking about that. So the Pali text, but in English letters, a translation of that, some commentary, and then some footnotes about specific words. So you'll notice that it doesn't have it there, but the footnote about this idea of this world, for the most part excludes Buddhists, basically, like people who are tuned into the truth in that way. So most people, this world, Kaccāyana, for the most part, depends upon a duality, upon the notion of existence and the notion of non-existence. It's funny because I would assume that we're all okay with those ideas of existence and non-existence, like they are just kind of obvious, but are they? If you're like, no, it's not obvious what existence and non-existence is, then you have a tremendous leg up today. We are one step ahead of the game because for the most part, Kaccāyana, most people are pretty clear about what is existent and what is not existent, right? This, of course, would be existent, right? Whereas the pink flamingo is not existent. What pink flamingo, right? Candle, candle, real, existent, right? So for the most part, Katyayana, this world depends upon a duality. The idea that there are some things that exist, and I guess an infinitude of things that don't exist, right? So that's the basic idea, but let's get deeper into what the Buddha's talking about. This next sentence, or next couple of sentences, are a little tricky. But for one who sees the origin of the world as it really is with correct wisdom, there is no notion of non-existence in regard to the world. And let me put these together and then we'll talk. And for one who sees the cessation of the world as it really is with correct wisdom, there is no notion of existence in regard to the world. So, we are going for today, we are going for seeing things as they really are with correct wisdom. That's what the Buddha would like Kaccānagotta to establish. That's what we're after today. So, in terms of seeing the world as it really is with correct wisdom, in terms of where the world came from, so in terms of the origin of the world, so for one who sees the origin of the world as it really is with correct wisdom, there is no notion of non-existence. And for one who sees the cessation of the world as it really is with correct wisdom, there is no notion of existence in regard to the world. So this is going to take a minute, by the way, to unravel. It is not impossible. We are very going to get there, but I will tell you that it's going to take a second. All right. So again, I want to encourage everybody that if you feel the need to get up, it might be a minute before I call for a break again. So everybody okay with that? Jimmy?
There was a notion in early catechism, early Catholic catechism that I was taught of the world has always been and always will be. World without end. And so there's that idea that as the world exists, it's always existed. There's no idea of non-existent. Is the world not existing? There's no idea of the world existing. So it's patently obvious. If it's here, then there ain't no not here. If it's not here, then there ain't no here.
It's actually simpler than I thought. Honestly, you nailed it. Allow me to unpack. But honestly, that's not too far from where we're headed. Except there's a few things. So let's kind of make it very clear what the Buddha is saying here. All right. So what I want you to think about, and I don't want to, I never want to harp on any other tradition or any other worldview. So I choose this at kind of just for simplicity's sake. But what I want to talk about is let's just for the sake of the next few minutes, I want to use for contrast the kind of Big Bang, Big Crunch model of science, right? So this idea of all matter and all energy and all everything in the universe as a singularity, and then this kind of explosion creating the world. And then when I was in school, at least, the idea was eventually gravity's going to catch up and start bringing everything back into that singular point. That was the story or mythology or science that I was told as a young. And so I'm going to go with that. I know that there's theories about the ever-expanding universe. Trust me, I know all these different theories, but let's deal with that one. So let us also clarify for this example that when we say the world, we don't mean that singular ball of energy and matter, because that is hardly a world. This is a world, right? So I want to make it clear that even though according to that model that I'm paraphrasing badly, according to that model, this singularity thing existed in that sense, but the world didn't exist. The world as we know it didn't exist. The world came into being from that Big Bang event. And so there is now a world that wasn't before, and this presently existing world will go out of existence based upon these definitions of what a world is. So I'm not talking about matter. I'm talking about the world as such. Now, the idea here is that for, let's kind of do this in like reverse engineer this. So the Buddha says that for one who sees the origin of the world as it really is with correct wisdom, there is no notion of non-existence in regard to the world. For one who sees the origin of the world as it really is, there's no notion of non-existence. Whereas for our Big Bang theorists, who understands the origin of the world that way, there is the non-existence of the world eventually. So that's sort of the normal view. And the Buddha saying, but one with correct wisdom who understands where the world really comes from, who understands the real origin of the world, they don't have the notion of the non-existence of the world. So, yeah, go.
So correct view is the non-existence.
Hold on.
Okay.
The Buddha's actually, yeah, I hear you, Brendan. And let's hold off on what right view is.
And
okay. Yeah. And then the other one, and for one who sees the cessation of the world as it really is, with correct wisdom, there is no notion of existence in regard to the world. Our big crunch friend who thinks the world is going to end and then come to a point of non-existence, ergo believes in the existence of the world presently. But one with correct, who sees the world correctly with correct wisdom, understands in regard to the cessation of the world, that the one with correct view understands, sorry, I'm getting my different models. For one who sees the cessation of the world as it really is with correct wisdom, there is no notion of the existence of the world. So Brendan, does the world exist?
Depends on your view.
It does depend on your view. That is a very correct answer.
Isn't that what you're getting at there?
Well, he's kind of, I take it at this point that the Buddha is sort of dismantling views, dismantling what would be called wrong views in this way, and kind of pointing at, and then he is saying that, but for one who has right view, they don't see it this way. But we don't fully know what right view is yet. We're basically understanding the problems of what the sutra will in a moment call the two extreme views. So many of you have probably already heard of this idea. Please, Renata.
Well, I guess when they say the world, they really mean the universe. I think the universe exists on a continuum that that planet could just destroy.
Great question. What do they mean by a world? I would strongly encourage us, even though I have been using the Big Bang model, when we're thinking from a Buddhist point of view about the world, I think it's very important to take a deeply subjective approach to the world. So what I mean is that when I think about, or if somebody talks about, I don't know, like planets and stars and like the idea of all of that, I don't ever get to see that. And even through a telescope, I only see a very, very small sliver of that. So if you describe the world as all of the planets and the stars and all of that, again, I've never had a view of all of that. But what I have had a view of all the time is this. And so the Buddhists are sort of not so, I mean, again, no offense, but the Buddhists aren't quite so science fictionally informed in that way.
But back then, they didn't have all these
And that's my exact point, is that when they talk about the world, they're talking much about the world, which is experienced from this point like this. And it's not experienced from a disembodied place floating in space, seeing the universe. That is always just an idea being entertained by this, if you know what I mean. So the Buddhists are very interested in this world and where this came from. And the idea of this world arising from, I don't know, and going to, I don't know. And the Buddha's talking about this idea of the world not existing, coming into existence and now currently existing, and then the idea of it going out of existence. And what the Buddha's about to get into is this idea of these two extreme views, which are understood as the idea of existence and the idea of not existence. And once again, Katyayana, this world, for the most part, depends upon a duality. Our thinking depends upon a duality. The duality that there is one category of phenomena existing, and there's another category of phenomena which is not existing. Those are the two kind of extreme views that we're going to be dealing with. And the Buddha is going to reconcile those by what is going to be called the middle way. So, yes.
I don't know if I'm mistaken, that wasn't the origin of the world or whatever one of the unconscionables?
I know. Yeah. Yeah, and it's basically for the reasons we're about to talk about, actually. Yeah. Yeah, no, but thank you actually for filling in that for me, because I was like, yeah, totally.
I can't imagine that this is accurate. I'm new at this, but I have this question.
Please, this is what I'm talking about. It's here. Yeah,
which is this pointing at like being comfortable with paradox?
Nope.
Thank you.
Yep. There are some maybe Zen teachers and what have you that might encourage that idea that these things are about being uncomfortable with paradoxes. But I assure you, if I fulfill my goal today, you will understand. You will understand this, and it's not a paradox. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
The question might be silly, but in yogic philosophy, there's an idea that the sense gates are not reliable, and you can't take what comes in through them seriously. And for myself, I became visually impaired suddenly, and suddenly that changed my experience of the world overnight. So it's how can we even make assertion, isn't it unknowable in a sense if it's so contingent on our sensory gates, the true nature of reality of the world?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. Is the idea of our sensory organs having a distorting effect and therefore being unreliable, right? That is certainly a wise understanding. And I say that because early Buddhism, in terms of the language of guarding the sense doors, very much interested in that reality, very much understanding that each of us is having our own unique perspective on things, and therefore asserting any kind of objective truth is, you've missed the mark from the beginning. Now, it'll be a little tricky because, and I need to share this with everybody. Actually, I don't need to share this with everybody. That would take us in the wrong direction. Sorry for thinking out loud there for a moment. But the idea here is it's going to ultimately be about dharmas. And what I mean by that, and if you don't know, this complicated word dharma has a lot of meaning to it, but I'm using the word dharma to refer to principles. So dharmas, plural, are principles that explain phenomena, but principles are not phenomena, right? This is like the laws of thermodynamics. The laws of thermodynamics are not things. They are principles that describe the behavior of things. So Buddhism indeed is not interested in relying upon sensory data, but it is interested in a certain understanding of dharmic principles. And that is actually where we can all agree, because according to the Buddhist tradition, all of our subjective experiences are arising out of the same dharmic principles. So what you want is not what I want, but us wanting things, that comes from the same place. So that's how I can understand you and you can understand me. Is the, yeah. Yeah. Questions, comments, answers, ideas. Okay. Everybody still cool with going on? I really don't want to like fatigue anybody because we could go, okay. So I do want to just get through this idea of the existence, non-existence of the world and this refutation of the ideas of existence and non-existence. So yeah, even before we get to the ideas of being shackled and all of that. So yeah, I'm gonna alleviate any intellectual stress here because I want to get to it. So here's the idea that we kind of want to be thinking about. And Jimmy actually said a lot of what I'm about to say. I'm just going to kind of put it a different way. So what the Buddha here is sort of thinking about or talking about, it would seem to me, is there's this way that we think, which is, again, in terms of existence and non-existence, right? But here's what we want to be paying a little bit of attention to. So let's say, whatever it is, I need something simple. I'll use a bowl, because a bowl is just a simple. So, oh, look, it's an existent bowl, right? So we have this idea that this bowl exists. Now, the thing about it, though, is if I were to take a flamethrower to this and begin melting it away and melting it away until eventually it ceased to exist, right? Then we would talk about what would we talk about, right? The bowl that doesn't exist, right? Huh, it sounds like there's a bowl in there somewhere. Somewhere. And what I mean is that, and by the way, I do want to recognize that I am taking a lot of knowledge and study and paraphrasing what the Buddha is saying here. So it's not really in the text what I'm saying right now. But the idea here is that we have this duality of things existing and non-existing. But if we look very, very carefully at what we think of as non-existent, we will notice that the object is still there. Because the reality is that non-existent is actually not existent. This is what Jimmy said, that to be non-existent, no name, no descriptive properties, nothing to distinguish it from anything else. Non-existent is non-existent. And therefore, when I talk about the bowl that doesn't exist, I start to sound a little crazy because I haven't escaped the concept of existence. I'm just sort of putting a weird label on the bowl, which is the label of not existing. Hi, my name is not existing, right? So you've put this weird label on something that doesn't exist, but that is still holding on to it in some kind of existent way. And therefore we haven't escaped, or we haven't actually gotten to non-existent. But our view, our thinking is actually predicated on these ideas. And why? Because we are probably all scared to death of going out of existence. So we actually do have a very clear, insofar as we are afraid of dying, we actually have a clear sense in our mind of what it is to not exist, or again, what we think non-existence is. And because, and this is where we're starting to get in a little deep, what we really want to start noticing is that for me to think that that exists right now, I have to have this idea of it not existing. And what I mean is that if there wasn't that looming possibility of non-existent, I wouldn't need to talk about this existing. It would be the most assumed, again, we wouldn't need a word for such a thing. Everybody follow me on what I mean by that? That our very way of thinking about something currently existing is like holding at the same time its non-existence. And what that means is that the way that we think about things is in this dualistic mode. And what I mean by that is, again, is that what it is to exist is to not yet be in the state of non-existence. And these are going to be ideas of kind of relative definitions of things. Just like, as many of you, if you've studied with me before, we understand that the idea of being tall, no one is tall. You are only tall relative to somebody who is short. Nobody is short. They are only short relative to people that are tall. And therefore, you are neither tall nor short. You're only tall or short relative to other things, right? And so that idea, what that means is that in and of myself, I am not tall or short. Everybody follow me on that one? And it's only once you put somebody else next to me that you'll say, oh yeah, Michael's a tall guy. But then you put me next to LeBron James, and now I'm the short guy. And what that points to, if you look at it really carefully, is that I am neither tall nor short. Well, now let me ask you, do I exist? Me being an existing thing is only relative to my buddy here, who doesn't exist. So you've got him that doesn't exist and him who does exist. But what I want you to notice is that if you are projecting existence onto me, it is just like projecting tallness onto me. I'm not tall, but I could be perceived as tall relative to other things. I'm not existent, but I could be perceived as existent relative to the idea of non-existence.
I guess it's almost part of my mind. I think maybe sometimes we
Indeed, Renata, and actually,
then house that burns down is no longer useful.
Sure.
It's just a house that burned down. Can't live.
And you're very insightful. What it sounds to me like you're referring to is, you know, what is that? He's describing the use value of it. That it could be used that way, right?
No,
it's a hearing aid. And I'm serious, I can hear you all much more clearly with it. So it is now functioning.
Yeah.
It could cover up my lawn. It could be a stool, it could be a footstool. We could be here all day. It's actually, for me, the fun part about Dharma that way is realizing how rigid our minds are. And we could actually be much more artistic and beautiful and creative and poetic if we understand that this could be anything. And it really could. And what we realize in that, when I show you the hearing aid, when I show you the hat, when I show you these things, it might be that you're like, oh, that's cute that you're using the bowl that way. But that, of course, is ignoring the point, which is this insistence that it is a bowl. And there, and we could also then get into ideas of emptiness this way by realizing that it isn't anything inherently, but it could be used in a variety of ways. And when it's being used that way, we could conventionally call it a hearing aid. And where we get wrong, of course, is when we go, you're a hearing aid and you're only a hearing aid. And anybody says otherwise, we're going to have an argument. And I say that seriously because what the Buddha is actually interested in is contention, is what we fight over. What do we fight over? Worldviews. That's actually what we're ultimately arguing and fighting over, is the idea that my worldview is right, and I'm sorry, but yours is wrong. And if I'm loud enough or persuasive enough, I could convince you that I'm right. And ultimately, we're going to want to be very careful about our adherence to any worldview. We're going to be want to hold all views very gently, but not because I mentioned it, not because I said so. We want to hold them gently because we realize that that's wise. So, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Let's take a break. Should we take a break? Or we can just keep going. I can keep going. But let's take a quick 5-ish minute break. Let's let all of that settle. And then we'll get back to the sutra. And if anybody has any questions, I am here.
How do you spell
Drishti? D-R-S, but it's a sh, H-T-I.
I've just heard it pronounced so many different ways. I once thought I said Drishti.
It's definitely a sh, a drish. Drishti. It's going to be this same question of whether an idea exists or doesn't, and the idea of where it exists, and realizing that we have a lot of pre-formulated ideas about things, that ideas are somehow in there and that they exist. And so we're going to today want to apply these teachings even to ideas.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm going to talk with you
We are actually missing anything else. There is a language called Buddhist hybrid Sanskrit. It is its own language. It is a language.
I'm going to tell us, I'm going to give you a little bit of a
Yep, that's it.
She is he's
calling it out.
Okay.
Oh yeah.
I wasn't sure if like that was what you said. Oh, it's sort of the same word. In our word for view. Okay.
Yeah, but he's saying that's a problem.
Right. Or be aware of it.
Yeah. Exactly. Okay. Better sense. Yay. Yeah, 2:30, we're good. A couple minutes, we're fine. I feel like there'll be a natural. Bring the hearing aid.
I think that's the plan.
Well, early, you know, the early Buddhists were material reductionists, but 2,000 years ago, that was pretty radical.
Right? Like, kind of hit the way he, because he's like he's trying to lay out, like, if you believe this, then you can't believe this other thing. That's the right view. Or view this view. And if you believe this other thing, then your right view is different than the other guy.
He's saying, if, for somebody who knows where the world really comes from, they won't talk about non-existence. And for somebody that really understands the non-existence of the world, they wouldn't talk about existence.
I see that.
Okay. I should have been there.
I think this translation is on the different merit.
It is.
Then the other one, and it's, yeah, I think that's part of it. But yeah.
All right. Let's go ahead and get back into it, everybody. So where we're going to start now is on the third paragraph. So we've dealt with this kind of basic idea of existence and non-existence. And for somebody who understands where the world really comes from, they're not going to talk about non-existence. And for somebody who understands where the world really disappears to, they wouldn't talk about existence. So in other words, and you know, Brendan had brought up the idea of the right view. And so far what we know about the right view is that somebody who has right view isn't going to insist on the existence or non-existence of things. That's all we've sort of learned so far, right?
Okay,
oh, please.
And I don't necessarily want us to go off on a tangent, but this like really feels to me like it's pointing towards thusness and suchness,
mm-hmm.
like from a very early time.
Yes. And what we, Tanya's mentioning this idea of tathata, the suchness or thusness, a very important Mahayana Buddhist idea. This sutra being from the Pali canon in the early teachings, it's not going to mention that, but yes, I want you to know that that is the, like, if there were part two, that's what it would talk about.
Yeah, it feels like it's pointing
yeah.
towards that.
Yes. So, okay. So as a continuation of the Buddha's answer to Katyayana, he says, this world, Kaccānagotta, is for the most part shackled by engagement, clinging, and adherence. But this one, the one with right view, does not become engaged and cling through that engagement and clinging. Mental standpoint, adherence, underlying tendency. And just for clarity's sake, I'm going to read this other version. Usually, Kaccānagotta, this world is bound to the tendency to grasp at stratagems. And that obstinate tendency of the mind to grasp at stratagems, this noble disciple, the one with right view, doesn't hold, doesn't insist on the self is mine. All right, we're going to hold off on the self bit in it for a second, but I want to talk about this idea of engagement, clinging, and adherence, but how somebody with right view doesn't become engaged and cling. And then we'll talk about the rest of that sentence. So, because we're talking about views, and I mentioned the idea that you could think about religious views or political views. Those are very much part of like worldviews in that way. Let's think about it this way. I want you to think about one of right view, a noble disciple of right view, who is witnessing two people having a heated argument about religion or politics or what have you, right? I know it's hard to believe. I know it's hard to imagine, right? People arguing about politics and religion, but let's pretend like there's two people that are going at it, right? And one person stands on one side, and let's say, I'll avoid getting myself into trouble. So let's stick with religion. So let's say one person is a staunch Christian, very much believing in God, creator, so on and so forth. And they're up against someone who is a staunch materialist, reductionist, scientist, doesn't believe in any of that God mumbo jumbo and all of that. And let's say these two people are having one of those arguments and that they are both trying to convince the other that they're right, right? What I want you to think about is our noble disciple, one of right view. And now what we can think of is this idea of engagement. And what I want you to think about is the temptation to get involved in that conversation. Maybe you have your view and you think they're both wrong and you want to get that across, or maybe you side with one person or the other. So I want us to be thinking about engagement in that regard. Now, in terms of Buddhism, in terms of where the sutra comes from, meaning it comes from a monastic tradition, they're actually talking about engagement with the world entirely. They're talking about jobs, family, all of that stuff, not getting engaged with any of that. I like to teach Dharma, of course, from a broad spectrum where it could be interpreted either strictly in a monastic way or from a householder way. So I choose an example like a heated argument and this temptation to get involved, to get engaged in that way. And then this idea of clinging to my point of view that I'm going to get across to both of these people in that way, and adhering to my worldview that I'm clinging to, and then getting engaged in this conversation. And what we want to be thinking about is, well, we certainly want to be kind of thinking about where this is headed in terms of the arising of suffering in that way. But even just from a practical point of view, I don't want to, like, don't even worry about Dharma just yet. I want us to think about, like, what we might think is to gain in that engagement. What we think there is to gain in the clinging and adherence to a worldview in that way. Or you could flip it and think, what do we potentially think is the risk of not engaging? What do we think is the risk of not clinging or not adhering to a worldview, right? And kind of what I want you to think about again is, if there's this temptation to get involved in that argument and argue as well, again, what are we hoping to accomplish in that, right? If we really looked at it, we probably don't even know, except for maybe self-expression and being heard, right? We all would like to express ourselves and we all would like very much to be heard. I think that's a commonality in a lot of ways. But beyond those sort of more just instinctual tendencies of wanting to express ourselves and wanting to be heard, the idea is, what is there to gain in an argument? My experience has been that worldviews are very hard to change. That once somebody has a worldview, it's nigh impossible to actually move out of that, or at least there's a way in which someone has to come, say, to a Dharma class, which exhibits a kind of willingness to explore and a willingness to abandon a worldview if there's something better that comes along. So my point is that there's this adherence and clinging to a worldview, and then we might have it, and then we might want to get engaged in an argument to express that worldview and all of that. And again, I'm just throwing it out there, like what we all might think is the value in getting involved. My personal exploration of it, of my own desire and tendency to do that is this idea that I must put a stop to this person's view. I must spare the world from this person. If this worldview gets out, if it gets out, it's like, it's over. So I have to stop this now. And that one really should investigate, that I have investigated my own tendency and my own unwillingness to allow others to have their own point of view. I have explored my own unwillingness to do that. And my practice in terms of Dharma and in terms of this has been about actually trying to listen to people, actually trying to understand in that way. And what that does for me is that is an exercise of non-engagement. That is an exercise of not clinging and not adherence, which is to be open to, A, open to the possibility I'm wrong, open to the possibility of change and all of these things. So let's think about those two possibilities, which is diving into that argument, you know, rolling up our sleeves and really getting into it versus not engaging, not clinging, not adhering. And again, I'm going to leave it up to you to decide, like, why would you do one? What are the benefits of one? What are the benefits of the other? All right. So those are seeds planted as we move ahead. I don't like to come down too, you know, firm on ideas like that of what one should do or shouldn't do, but those are some suggestions of ways to think about a situation like that. Yeah. And of course, when the Buddha says that for the most part, this world is shackled by clinging, that of course is noble truth, right? That is part of the basic teachings of Buddhism. So nothing should really be a surprise in that. So our noble disciple, one of right view, and I'm reading from this translation now, I will back up, by the way, and explain mental standpoint and underlying tendency. But when it says the one of right view with the noble disciple of the right view, they do not take a stand about myself. This translation is pretty nice, which is the one where it says, they do not insist on the self is mine. So this, of course, is a very fundamental Buddhist teaching, of course, this teaching of no self, right? I particularly like this language that Jayarava translates as, which is this idea that the self is mine. So if you don't know, let me give you just a really quick, a hyper quick lesson in no self in that way. Because I know that this is a tricky teaching in that regard, because we all think we exist in that way, right? So when the Buddhists are talking about the self, they have a particular idea in mind. It has to do with the language of upadana. So upadana is the language of clinging, but if you really look into the word upadana, clinging isn't, I mean, it's a fine translation, but there is a kind of a better way or a more expedient way to translate that word. And upadana would be best translated, in my opinion, as appropriation. And I know that that's kind of a tricky word, to appropriate something, but, you know, to appropriate, it's kind of about ownership in that way, to appropriate. And what we want to be thinking about is this. So let me walk you quickly through this idea. What it is that we talk about that we have hands. We don't necessarily think I am hands. We think I have hands. And that is probably not entirely wrong in that way, because if I thought I am hands, if I lost a hand, I would die. I would no be longer existent. I would no longer be existent. But that's not true. We know that we can lose a finger, we could lose a hand, we could lose both hands, And what we would say is, I lost my hands. I had hands. I don't have hands anymore. Everybody with me on this logic? Ergo, you are not your hands. Fair enough. I assume that this logic goes for our feet as well, and our legs, and our ears, and our nose, and our eyes. And actually, we could say, I lost my eyes, I lost my ears, I lost. So, question, what is it that has hands? What is it that has legs, feet, ears, eyes, and this and that? What is it that has those things, that isn't those things, but has those things? And let me give you one even better. Where is that which has hands? Where are you? And this is where people start feeling like they might be behind the eyes and between the ears. And that's a logical conclusion given the way the senses create, the way the fact that we have predator eyes, we do not have the eyes of prey, right? You know, this animals that are prey have eyes on the side of their head so that they can keep a lookout. Animals that are predators have two eyes in front of them so that they can target in on the prey. It's why owls have those big forward-facing eyes, and other birds that are preyed upon have eyes that are more to the side. And if you're a crazy chameleon, you're all over the, you got to keep a, you know, lookout all over the place. I digress. The fact that we have these predator eyes in the front of our face, they do create the perception of front and back. And the fact that we have these ears on the side of our heads do create the ideas of left and right and the sides of me. So there is a reason why we think we might be there somewhere. And it's because the way the sensory experience is sort of creating that. And an interesting thing about this, by the way, why is it when we're in a dream, there's in front of us and we can't see behind us? You're not using these eyes. So why would you not be able to just see? Why do you keep only being able to see front and you can't see behind you in a dream? Could it be that it's a product of conditioning and that you carry that conditioning over with you in a dream and only allow yourself to have the experience of forward, back in that way? Again, I digress, because what we're interested in is, what is this self that we cling to so clearly as ourself? So what I want you to now think about, let's do this a little bit in reverse. A moment ago, I was talking about how I have hands. And what that is the appropriation of hands. And I could, by the way, and this is what Buddhism is talking about to a great degree. So I, and let's for the sake of right now, just presume that there is a self or even a provisional self. There's a way in which I go, ooh, my feet, my hands, my body, my socks, my pants, my clothes, my water. You see the appropriating that's going on here? And it extends, it begins with the appropriation of the body, or actually it doesn't begin with the appropriation of the body. I'm beginning with the appropriation of the body, which then we start going like, ooh, yeah, ooh, yeah, ooh, yeah. And what I want you to think about, because I think about this a lot, let's say that you have your car, or you have your front lawn, or you have these things of yours, right? It's about the way that we might react if somebody puts their hand on my car or steps on my lawn, or, you know, has their dog come on my lawn. Hey, that's my lawn. And there's a way in which we could react and get angry at that as if they have shat upon us, as if they had touched us when they're just putting their hand on a car. No, they're putting a hand on my car, and now I'm offended. So what we want to notice is that there is this appropriating of the body, appropriating of belongings, but then what's happening is there is this expansion of a sense of self that includes these objects, and we start to respond to these objects as if they are ourselves. And we can get angry, or we can get pleased, or like if somebody compliments my wonderful cup of water, I go, yeah, it's nice, huh? I get a warm, fuzzy feeling as if somebody paid me a compliment, but it's my cup. So it is a compliment to me. You see where I'm going with this, which is when the Buddhists are talking about this self and then no self, they're talking about that self, the one that has things, the appropriator. But now let's go real deep in that. What I said, these are my words, not your words. These are my words. So I'm appropriating these sounds coming out of my face, and I'm calling them mine. Ooh, better yet, my ideas. That was my idea. It came out of my brain, mine, right? And what we want to start noticing is that there could possibly be thinking without the appropriation of thought. And by appropriation of thought, I mean the added layer of it's my idea. But there's a feedback loop going on that the Buddha detected, which is that when we appropriate, there is the fabrication of that appropriator. So that the appropriator, which would be a better word than self, if we were to get kind of deep into the language, and by the way, later Buddhist traditions do call the seventh aspect of consciousness the adanna consciousness, the appropriating consciousness. So there is a version of Buddhism where they actually do call the self the appropriator. But what we want to be kind of then, right now, we should all kind of be swashing around in this possibility of like, okay, so I'm appropriate, my hand, my thoughts. What would that be like to not appropriate? And what I'm getting at is that I know that sometimes when we hear this idea of no self, we feel as if to believe that, or to own that, or to whatever, we sense a risk of going out of existence. And all the more reason to come back to this fundamental teaching we're talking about, which is this duality of existence and non-existence. So again, what I'm getting at is that there might be a way to, and now language falls apart, right? There might be a way to what? To be? No. But provisionally, I will use language to say there might be a way to not appropriate. And what that would mean is that there would be thinking, and there would be talking, and there would be all the activity, but without that extra added layer of the appropriating of it as mine, in exactly the same way that I can use this cup, drink from the cup, and I don't need to call it mine. It functions all the same. It fulfills all the same purpose. But I also then could do this with the appropriation that it's my cup. You could do it both ways, if you see what I'm saying. And there's one that has a mental inclination, a mental clinging to this as my cup. And from a Buddhist point of view, and I want to state this, I need to be stressing this more. Today is, I know it's kind of philosophical, and we're talking about existence and non-existence, but what I want you to understand is that if this is not appropriated, well, perfect. You worked perfect, buddy. If you came and took it, it's not my cup. He needed a cup. Great, it was a cup. But if it's my cup, now there's problems. And there's not problems between us. No, there's problem because I'm going to be suffering. and be like, ah, my cup, how am I supposed to drink? Right? Well, the same thing happens, of course, with our own bodies. And this is where I want to mention one more idea about no self before I open it up for questions or we go further. We want to think about this. So you may have had this thought. You may have heard someone express this thought. And it is the thought that when we get into Dharma and Buddhism, when we start learning about maybe the aggregation of the skandhas, for example, like the formation of the body and all of that. And in particular, we learn about the ever-morphing, ever-changing aggregation of the five skandhas. That thought moment to thought moment to thought moment, there is a different state of consciousness. There's a different state of conditioning. I'm perceiving. So there's perception is always changing. Our conditioning is always changing based on new experiences. Present state of consciousness is constantly changing based upon different perceptions. Our sensory bodies are constantly changing. The temperature might fluctuate. The light may fluctuate. All of that affects our sensories. And then the body, the first aggregate, is always changing too, right? There, it just changed. It's one hair less, right? So the five aggregates are in this ever state of change, all five of them. So hearing that, knowing that, understanding that, you may come to this bright idea. There have been all of these different versions of me. Okay. Versions of me. What's the me that is then there are different versions of? What's the original copy? Well, like, what's the original that these are versions of? And what we realize is, oh, it's just the versions, but there isn't any referent of the way the me in that way. So what I'm getting around to, again, is that this concept of me, of the self, that the Buddhists are always saying, yeah, there's not that, it's actually a particular fiction that we create. And it comes from appropriation. It comes from all these different things I've been talking about. And the main thing I kind of wanted to get across right now is that you don't need to have that. And in fact, if the Dharma says that is only suffering, that self, that's all that's doing actually is creating suffering. Let me give you an example. It may so happen that let's say I get a gash, a huge gash down my face. It's grotesque. And I'm upset about it because I don't look that way. Right? I don't have a gash. No, I'm sorry, you do. But notice the suffering that comes from comparing the present state to what we think of as my real self that doesn't have a gash. The problem with that is that you will just be in a perpetual state of suffering, your existence in that sense, meaning your present reality existence where you have a gash on your face. But the suffering's coming from you're comparing it. Or, of course, thinking about the way people are going to view you, judging you. All of that's ego. All of that is this delusional sense of self that, again, it's just suffering. Now, if you ask me, Michael, the teacher, well, then, Michael, what is that? What is it? What is that to be without self? If, you know, all of that, wouldn't I just go brain dead? Or, like, what are we talking about? Well, for me personally, in the way that I practice, the way that I teach, the best way that I have figured to describe what it is to be without a self in the way that we're talking is what is kind of colloquially known as a flow state. And if you think about this idea of being in a flow state experience, you want to notice that there is a feeling of the doing without a doer. There's a feeling of being so immersed in the activity that there is just the doing of the activity without that extra layer of me doing the activity. Or in particular, any kind of notions of like, oh, everybody's going to think I'm so cool when they see the, what I'm working on. Actual flow state is actually not considering what people will think, not having that sense of self, but just being fully immersed in what you're doing. Now, for many of us, it needs to be kind of an intense exercise, you know, maybe surfing, maybe skateboarding, maybe something that is really commanding you to be present, to then force you to be present so that you are forced to not appropriate in that way. In fact, what often happens, I've given a Dharma talk about that regarding skateboarding. Often when you're in that state, as soon as you start becoming self-reflective, you fall. And so that is sort of an indication that I often like to make clear that actually, if you look at a flow state and you look at being and doing, but without that sense of self, we are usually at our optimal, best, most, and most joyful. Who's ever said, yeah, I was in a flow state, it was terrible. It's the worst day of my life, I was just blown. You know, everybody kind of recognizes that there is this way of being. And again, when I use this word being, it's provisional, all of that. But there is a way of being in the world where there is the doing. And by the way, it happens in conversation too, where you can get so kind of immersed in a conversation that before and after, and especially if it's maybe with a lover, self and other start to dissolve, and there's just really being in it. And I would strongly encourage, or at least my understanding of the Dharma is that the Buddha always wants us to be having a much better time than we're having. That's really what this is about. This suffering idea is that we're not actually having as good a time as we could be having. And so the idea is that if you, for me, again, if a reference is to this idea of a flow state as what it might be like, but not just for a moment, not just during a session, but all the time. Okay. Any questions, comments, answers, ideas about the self, no self idea? That was my best shot at describing that.
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to say, I just comment on what you were just saying, that I love it. It's like, it's not about just on the pillow, it's off the pillow, it's like everything.
Yes. But cushion practice, of course, helps cultivate that, because often being in the world forces us to appropriate in that way. So it's nice to settle down and not appropriate for a while.
I'm really trying to think about an appropriate flow state.
All right, yeah. You could certainly do it retrospectively in that way, where it was like I was in a flow state, right? But when it's happening, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is more common than anything else. It sprang to my mind when you were talking about flow state, when you're letting go of that idea. And then I was reading, I'm sure lots of people probably read Daniel Kahneman's Thinking Fast and Slow. And he talks about the difference, or is there a difference really between, I mean, there's a preference people have for a remembering self versus an experiencing self. Hmm. And how the idea of like, oh, I think I'm gonna look cool doing this thing or whatever. You're kind of, I think there could be a tendency to try and create a memory for yourself that have all of these attributes. And then that kind of really very much takes you out of the experience. So I mean, he gets way into it, not such a good thing. It's like, if you didn't know that you, like say you had a surgery that's incredibly painful, but they give you a drug so you won't remember it. And you get woken up, like you go to the hospital, you get woken up the next morning and they say, oh, you know what? You're fine, everything's great, and you're good. And you're like, oh, great, I don't know. It was very painful, but you don't remember. And then somebody comes back and says, oh, actually, we made a mistake. You haven't had that surgery yet. And it's like, what happens? You're anticipating, you're thinking about it. Mm-hmm. And would you choose that if it was going to be half as painful if you knew? But if you're going to forget, and this whole idea of something kind of puts it, I think it kind of revives this idea that, like, well, how can, but neither one of those things are self, really.
Right.
mean, it's.
But the experiential one is a little closer to what we're talking about.
Yeah. Absolutely. And the idea of remembering or creating or remembrance for yourself is it's kind of a additional percentage.
Mm-hmm. No, yeah.
I appreciate this. The idea, I just heard a talk and podcast, and they replaced the word suffering with stress. And it makes so much more sense.
Yeah.
That the idea, because suffering is such a huge word, it points to an idea of I am suffering, I am stressed. But stress is like, oh, this is causing, this is causing this stress.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. Thirsty of stress. And also, this really points to the what you've been talking about, points to the yogacara of the maha. Of the seventh consciousness that came later,
mm-hmm.
The yogacara,
mm-hmm.
points to this also.
Sure.
That, oh, you know, here's the I see, I smell, I taste, I hear, you know, and I have mental thoughts. And then there's the conscious mind,
mm-hmm.
that aspect of removing the mind.
Right. Versus there is hearing happening.
It's hearing happening. My eye.
That's the trick that I hear versus there is hearing happening.
And that's the connection with suffering. The connection with stress.
Sure.
That's the thing. This is stressful. I have to wear these iPod things in order to hear.
Mm-hmm.
And I could be stressed out about it. They actually are quite helpful.
There you go.
So, it's a perspective.
Please.
How do you separate like a minimal sense of self from like pathological or less desirable states, like depersonalization, which could cause suffering in our right?
Really, really great question. Yeah. That's a really, really interesting question. Yeah.
Can you repeat that?
Oh, yeah, sorry. So the question was about how, and I'm going to butcher it, of course, but there are other, either so states of disassociation, right? These other states that might seemingly be without a self or be that way. And how does that relate to what we're talking about? Does that sound like a good summary? Yeah, and it's a really interesting question. And the thing about it is that I do think, and this is not from my own personal experience, but from working with students who have had various traumatic experiences where they were in an altered state where maybe there wasn't a self, or maybe there wasn't language, or maybe there wasn't these things. And then coming back online, so to speak, there is a sort of wondering about what was that versus this? And, you know, this gets delicate and tricky, especially when we get into, you know, such a, we cannot just talk about a disassociated experience in a general sense, because there's psychotic breaks, and then there's also an anechoic chamber and, you know, sensory deprivation where you could bring about such a state. So I want to be very careful about that. But in general, I would suggest that there are a variety of ways to bring about, or even just by happenstance or circumstance, there's a way to bring about experiences of no self. And what I would suggest is that they are like, how can I put it? It's a lot like drugs. And what I mean is that there's a way in which there's a lot of various chemical substances that you can take to induce meditative experiences and all kinds of experiences. And the idea is that, yeah, that's it. But the problem from a Buddhist point of view and ideas of, say, wrong samadhi, for example, like there's right samadhi, right? Union. And if everybody doesn't know, the idea of samadhi is this sense of unity or oneness, not being in a subject-object relationship with the world, but actually having it blur and having a union experience is like a samadhi, can take on a lot of different experiences, eyes open, eyes closed. But the idea is that there's a pill I can take that will dissolve my sense of self and I'll be in a samadhi. From a Buddhist point of view, the problem with that though is what happens when you don't have the substance? And not only that, you have conditioned yourself to rely upon the substance and thus making it harder for you to experience it naturally and in a sustainable way. So my general answer to what you're suggesting is that they're probably related, but they're either unsustainable or they arrived at in means that we don't even know, or maybe like a car accident. And I'm not getting in a car accident to get to nirvana. I'm not interested in doing it that way. So my point is that there is this very slow, gradual meditative course, which is the process of the four foundations of mindfulness, and then the dhyanas and the samadhis. And there's this very established way to cultivate these states that's very endogenous, if you will. And by endogenous, I mean just internal to our own system in that sense, to where the meditation is releasing, if we want to get scientific about it, that the meditation is releasing a lot of the same endogenous chemicals and producing the same kind of experience in that way. So it's about dependency, and I don't necessarily mean chemical dependency, but that idea of needing a crutch and then the problems of doing that. So, yeah. Yeah, Tanya.
I had thought like some things that we do that don't seem very skillful seem to me that they might do sort of a flow state. Like, I know, like when I'm internet surfing, I forget I'm there. Mm-hmm. And so that seems to me like sort of a flow state. But on the other hand, it seems like an incredible waste of time. Or like, you know, zoning out, binge watching, mm-hmm. you know, 10 episodes of Ted Lasso. So I'm curious. I mean,
allow me to clarify.
Yeah, thanks.
And I feel like I made some remark about this, but I would really like to make it clear that I am using the flow state as an analogy, that is what, like, if we haven't had a full experience of no self, but we have had an experience of flow state, I am suggesting that it's like that. But what you're describing, I would suggest, you know, when you're in the binging mode of surfing the internet, how's your neck?
I'm not paying attention, but if I stop paying attention, yeah, I'd be like.
I guess that's what I mean, is sort of, yes, there is, and it is very related to the answer I just gave, that there are other means to bring about similar or comparable experiences. But the question is about, well, especially if you take something like entertainment or just the internet or stimuli, what it's about actually is about, so we stimulate ourselves to a point of, call it ecstasy, but stimulate ourselves to a point of flow state, then turn off the computer and we're bored.
Yeah, so we're still.
And that's the problem, is we've conditioned ourselves to get into a quote flow state through these, as you put it, unskillful means. And then what that, it's a detriment to the long-term practice. It's a quick fix. And we know about quick fixes, or, you know, I think we all know about quick fixes. They feel good in the moment, but if we're in this for the long haul in that way, there, it's not sustainable. So, yeah. Yeah, Brendan.
The original question was like how to notice a flow state or how to be in a flow state.
Tanya's?
No, I think you had a question.
My question is more like how you distinguish between undesirable states like depersonalization and no self.
And actually, I didn't even catch that key word. Undesirable.
Yeah.
The one we're talking about is very desirable in the sense of enjoyable, pleasurable, wonderful. That's all I want to be, versus scary. Get me out of here. We're not talking about that. Yeah, that's a good litmus test to say, are you enjoying it?
I mean, I remember, yeah, just like sorting silverware at a restaurant at my work, and at a certain point I was just like, I don't know who's doing this. Like, this is enormously complex. I mean, I can't say that I'm like doing this.
Yep.
Like, and it was like not just, you know, dexterity, but like my mind is identifying the force and
putting it
together. And it was just like, oh yeah, I don't, you know, I'm here, but like I can't say that I am actually in charge of this. Like, that I can stop it. but, you know, yep. Happens over time.
That's exactly what we're talking about. And we're talking about the idea of cultivating such an experience, but just walking down the street or just doing whatever. Yes, ma'am.
I just got a comment, like, but it seems to me there's a difference between like flow and autopilot.
Yes.
Right? And like in the flow state, you're like hyper present.
Yes.
Versus like when I'm watching Netflix or when I'm doing something like mind numbing, it's almost the opposite of like, I'm not there, but I'm not even aware of not being there.
Yes.
Whereas you're rock climbing or something, it's like a hyper presence, you're aware of everything.
Yes. Excellent example and good point to make. It's kind of along the ideas of what Brendan was saying, is sort of like, even though he's just doing this mundane thing, there's like a precision in it and a clarity and all of that, and rock climbing and all of that. So very good point to make. This is not about being brain dead or checked out in any way. It's actually quite the opposite.
I'm hearing like, it sounds to me like, you know, there's a flow state and there's addiction.
Sure.
Addicted.
Sure.
And the concept of presence is key differentiation between the two. Are you,
good call.
Are you present or are you checked out?
Great call. We are trying to be hyper present, not checked out. Absolutely. Yes.
Is that anything like being in a mental clarity where you stop the excursion thought and you can almost see your, like your pancreas is doing what it does, and your brain is like, what about this? What about that? But you're thinking and the observer is separate. As per the classic Pali too.
Yeah. What we are talking about has to do with discursive thought, for sure, and the absence of discursive thought. The absence of the reflection that I am doing this and there is just the present doing of it. So let's settle on that kind of a distinction to make, that the discursive thought, the chatter is gone, but we are not checked out, we are not brain dead, we are not in a comatose state, but far, far from it in that way.
The best description I've ever heard of flow state is that sweet spot between something where it's not so easy that it's boring and it's not so challenging that it's super stressful. It's that spot where full absorption is happening. So you're doing, where it's starting to get bored, that you get in the default mode network of daydreaming, wool gathering, any future past. So especially you're both in pain and suffering, and this upsetting.
Yep.
And that is very much it.
Sure. That's where we're going.
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
There's a question online.
Oh, yeah.
Should I read it?
Please. And I'll repeat.
Okay. What is the relationship of no self to the mundane, logistical day-to-day of life where you have to fight for things, your rights, your needs, go to work, etc., especially if you struggle with money or medical conditions? We have to fake self to get some needs met, but we don't quite believe the demands we make.
So I'm going to answer that question in a roundabout way, because there's something I want to mention or talk about that I think addresses that, not directly. So I recognize that. So whoever asked the question, I know I recognize this is not a direct answer, but it probably is related. So what I wanted to talk about is a few minutes ago, or however long ago it was, I talked about, we were talking about the idea of self, and we were talking about the idea of what happens when I get a big gash in my face and I'm suffering from it. And I don't mean suffering from the pain of the gash, but suffering this kind of ego who is that my face doesn't have a gash. But that's a disjuncture with the fact that you presently do, right? Well, let me give you a different one that I think is very interesting that, again, I wanted to share it earlier. I think it applies. It's this one. It's the idea, and I want to remind everybody, for what I'm about to say, we need to remember that about me not being tall or short, and even me not existing or existing. We need to remember that idea that I am not inherently tall or short. Interestingly, am I old or young? Now, one idea in terms of tall and short is that if you put me next to an octogenarian, I am young because I'm not 80 years old. But if you put me next to a newborn, I'm old. So there's that version of the dependent arising of my age, which is that my age is actually not inherent, it's relative. And when we get into the idea of numbers and the idea that I'm a certain number of years old, let us remember that numbers are also relative to other numbers and do not have inherent existence in that way. But rather than doing the thing where we are comparing me to either somebody that would be perceived as older or somebody that would be perceived as younger, let's not do it that way. Let's do it this way. I used to be so much younger. So I'm comparing this to that, but I'm saying that there's a me that is the real me. And the reason why I might be upset about being old is because mentally I'm comparing it to the young me and saying, I'm not old, I'm young. What's this gray? What's this gray doing here? And so I want everybody to notice that any anxiety that we have about aging, getting older, it's helpful to analyze why we think we are aging and old, especially in light of this idea that these characteristics, like being tall or short or young or old, are not inherent. They are all relative, relative to society. I mean, think about the idea of when the age expectancy was 30 or 35, right? All of a sudden, you're
when your friends start dying, I think that's when you realize we're old.
Well, that's another conversation. I'm not quite sure what dying has to do with age, because children die, everybody, people die at all ages, so death doesn't really have to do with age, right?
Yeah, but if you reach a certain age, it seems like you realize that a lot of people do no longer dare.
So, again, it's this idea of when I reach a certain age. Mm-hmm. Who's this I that is like headed towards a certain age? This is the very self or the I that the Buddha is saying is kind of a figment of the present imagination. That there is this self that exists in time. And as I often like to point out, we have to say, if I looked at a picture of me as a child, I'd say, look, it's me. Really? Because you look like you got a gray beard. You look like you got gray hair. That's not the picture of somebody with a gray hair. And I know that was me when I was young. But if you actually think about that idea, let's say it's a picture of me when I was 5, right? This me learned Chinese. I could speak Chinese. I speak a little Spanish. I've had all these experiences. I've been around the world. I've been married, all of these things. Has that person been married? Do they know those languages? So that's not me. If you're going to say this is me, because I'm the person that can translate Chinese, I'm the person that can do those things. That person can't do that. So how is that me? You don't get to have it both ways. You don't get to be both 5 years old and an adult. You gotta make a choice in that. Do you really see what I'm saying? That you don't get to be both? Now, Buddhism is not denying a continuity that exists between that and this, but what they are saying is that this mental attachment to that as me and this is me is an utter delusion. You are two bodies at the same time, and you're comparing this to that because you're saying, I'm actually 5 years old. I cannot be 40, however old I am, because I'm 5 years old in that way. Once again, what the Buddha is, or what this teaching of no self really wants to do, is propel us deeply into this present moment and get rid of these fictions of a self that are keeping us in a weird relationship to time. And by the way, if you didn't already intuit this, me, right here, right now, if I say, yeah, that's me. Well, you know, when I was young, but that's me. If you think that, then you know what you are doing? You're creating that one, which is to say the dead one. Because if you're the birthed one, if you're the young one, then you're that one too. And that's what we're afraid, is that we identify with the young one, ergo, I'm that one too. And so now I sit here afraid of that, even though I'm right here. Hi, I'm a quote alive. But if I identify as the mortal one on their deathbed, dying already. But I want us to know where we get that idea. How would you possibly identify with the future self that, by the way, the future doesn't exist? We all, everybody kind of recognize that, right? So the future doesn't exist, but we are certain about this one future event, even though that event doesn't exist, but it does in my mind. And again, what we're looking at is, where would I get such a cockamamie idea as that? And it comes from identifying as the child. You don't get to have it both ways. But if you realize that attachment to that childhood self is a delusion, and that you are not both of them, you are arguably not even this one, like we were just talking about regarding flow state, regarding all those things, you're arguably not even this. And what we want to notice is the utter freedom that comes from that. And what I mean is, all that childhood guilt and shame and all of that, you can just let it go, because it's not you. And all of those fears of down the road, you can forget. You'll get there. Don't worry about it. Right? And in my household, we have a saying, you don't let death win twice. And this might contradict what I have just said, but it's a personal thing. In my household, the idea is that death is probably going to win once, but every time we are worried about it, it wins twice, because we die now in that way that we fear it, that we live it, that we, all of these things. So rather than constantly dying twice in that way, how about just hold off? How about just hold off until we're there? And who knows?
It's the same for, you know, my fucked up childhood. Am I going to be nostalgic for this trauma that I went through? Or am I going to have, having learned from it and, you know, talking to it and moving on with it? And on the other hand, am I going to worry about when I'm going to die? Because all I know is that it's going to happen. I don't know when or how. I barely get to be here right now as it is without having to worry about what went on before and worry about what went on in the future. And that's a lesson that has taken me a long time to learn, and that I have to practice to remember to stay in touch with that my nostalgia for the past is nowhere near as valuable as I might think it is on any given day, nor is my worrying about the future anywhere near as valid as I may think it is at any given time.
Yeah, it kind of relates to, I think this is something that you said before. The memories that we're creating the past. It isn't necessarily an accurate memory of what happened.
This is a Buddhist position regarding the past.
It's just everything is just coming up now. And what we think is the past, it's not the past.
It's a justification for how it is we think we got here as this in that way. And by the way, Jimmy's comment, Tiny's comment, all these comments are bringing us right actually back to the sutra, like that segue, bringing it right back. But it is bringing it right back, because this idea of existence and non-existence, we want to go back to that idea of what I said, which is that I have the idea that I currently, presently exist. And that notion, thinking of it in that way, in those terms, the dualistic terms of existing, what the Buddha is saying is that when you think you exist, again, what you then have is this looming threat of not existing. But the only reason why you have this looming threat of not existing is because you have this strange thought of presently existing. And that's where we get into the Dharma that I walked us through, which is what exists. What is this self that you are talking about that currently exists that you're afraid of going out of existence? That five-year-old has already gone out of existence, right? So what are we actually worried about in that way? And the right view that we're going to get around to is this idea of the right view of the middle path between existence and non-existence. That's where we're hoping to get in the next half hour, is kind of reconcile that idea. Then what would it mean then to, for what would it mean to say that that bowl or I neither exist nor not exist? Because I want us to remember this idea of like the delusional sense of self. That delusional sense of self exists sort of. So what I'm getting at is that we want to recognize that we are very quick to go, oh yeah, that doesn't exist. Oh yeah, that exists. And that's the duality that the Buddha is pointing at, that our thinking is wrapped in these dualities. And it's almost like we don't even know how to not do it that way. So let's see if we can not do it that way. Yeah. Okay. So this noble disciple, the one with right view, does not take a stand about myself. And that's, again, the added language of that appropriation of the self. Now, they, meaning the one with bright view, has no perplexity or doubt that what arises is only suffering arising. And what ceases is only suffering ceasing. Their knowledge about this is independent of others. It is in this way, Kaccānagotta, that there is right view. So when it says, my interpretation, my understanding of when it says that they, meaning one with right view, has no perplexity or doubt that what arises is only suffering arising. The idea is this, and this is where, even though it's kind of rather late in the day, I am about to transition to talking about Nagarjuna, because I'm going to kind of, what I want you to know is that Nagarjuna reads this sutra a particular way. And that particular way, again, becomes the foundation of Mahayana. So that particular way is that the only thing that arises is suffering. However, you might think that, well, if we're talking about materiality, you might think that if I got together some clay and started on my potter's wheel, that eventually, and I know it's not clay, eventually a bowl would arise. The bowl didn't exist before, but then I put the clay on my potter's wheel and I made a bowl. So it arose. And the idea here is that you are, of course, aware that the Buddha has this teaching about all phenomena, all dharmas being impermanent. And there's many, many a way to interpret that. But a mainline Hinayana Theravada early Buddhist way, a mainline way of understanding that is that there is a bowl, but it ain't gonna last. There is an aggregation of the five skandhas, but they're not going to last. There's definitely not a self. Nobody thinks there's a self. You'd have to be a fool to think there's a self. But in the early Buddhist tradition, they do think there is the ever-changing, amalgamating formation of the body, and that there is a, quote, bowl. But the bowl is going to go out of existence. So we could talk about the arising, abiding, and ceasing of the bowl. Likewise, there's this idea that I don't know how old I am, I swear. 48 years ago? Oh no, I'm almost about to have a birthday. So maybe 49, I don't know. But somewhere in there, years ago, there's this idea that I was born. There wasn't me. Then I was born, and that's when it all started. I started existing. Then there's been this existing thing happening, and I exist. But the idea that we've been talking about is that there's this idea that eventually it's going to fall apart to the point where, boink, out of existence, right? No more existence in that way. So that would be the arising, abiding, and ceasing, not of Michael, because again, only a fool would think there's a self in that way, but there is the arising of this bodily formation. There is the abiding of this bodily formation, and then there will be the ceasing of that bodily formation. And that bodily formation is impermanent as a bowl as anything else. Also within the Buddhist tradition, they refer to the arising and the abiding and ceasing of phenomena like being angry. So there's the idea that I'm just chilling. That noise, anger. I was chilling a second ago, but there was the arising of anger. I am now totally angry, and they'll go away eventually. And when they go away, that's the ceasing of the anger. So there's this idea that there's the arising of the Dharma, a Dharma, which might be called anger, the abiding of that, and then the ceasing of that. And the early Buddhist tradition and the Theravada tradition that you may have all been exposed to, the early Buddhist path, I'm chill. The early Buddhist path is about observing the arising, abiding, and ceasing of dharmas. And what that means is that from modern Theravada Buddhist teachers teach the early Buddhist tradition saying that in a meditative state, you observe the arising of a emotional phenomena, something like anger. You observe it arising, you observe it abiding, and then you observe it ceasing. And the value of that exercise is that there could be a tendency that there's an arising of an emotion, and I'm going to ignore that. I'm going to repress that. I'm not going to look at it. I'm just going to sweep it under the rug. That would not be wise. That would not be skillful in that way. So we don't want to ignore the arising of these emotions, but we also don't want to kind of add fuel to the fire. And what I mean by that is, so let's say I'm chilling here and the loud car goes by and there's the arising of anger. I could shamatha out, I could chill out and observe, wow, that noise is really making me angry. I'm really angry about that noise. Like, it's really true that I'm angry about that noise. Or the arising of anger and that, and now I'm adding fuel to the fire. I'm getting angry and I'm taking karmic action with my body and my voice and my mind that are feeding the anger and making it more and more and more. We definitely don't want to do that. So the Buddha came up with this really surefire way of dealing with emotions, which is rather than repressing and ignoring them, and rather than leaning into them and making them worse, we stop and observe their arising, their abiding, and because of impermanence, all things must pass away and they will eventually subside and cease. Nagarjuna interprets this particular sutra in a very different way in terms of when the Buddha says, the one with right view has no perplexity or doubt that what arises is only suffering arising. And the only thing ceasing is suffering ceasing. The way that Nagarjuna interprets that is that, well, just to cut to the chase, Nagarjuna interprets that as actually that there is that nothing exists inherently at all. anger doesn't exist inherently. The self doesn't exist inherently. Bowls don't exist inherently. Nothing exists inherently. And in fact, there is nothing. No physical phenomena arising, abiding, and ceasing. There is only suffering arising, and there's only suffering ceasing. So I'm sharing this with you, and I don't want to be the type of Dharma teacher to say, and that's the right way to think, because there's tremendous practical value in the early tradition and the way they do things. It's incredibly smart. It's incredibly wise. But if you want to get into like the deeper Dharma, there's actually no existent Dharmas. They actually don't exist or not exist in that way. So, but everybody okay with the paragraphs we covered? So we have one more paragraph. Yeah, no.
Yeah, I have a question.
Please.
Is my article saying that the only thing that arises is suffering? Because if you think that something is arising, that causes suffering? Is that what you're saying?
Noam said it. Yeah. Yeah. Please, Noam, and then I'll repeat.
When he's saying that the only thing that arises is suffering, and I'm saying that that's because if you think something else is arising, then you're
falling into suffering. The extreme view of existence.
Yeah.
Yes. Noam said the only thing arising is suffering, because if you think anything else is arising, you are asserting that there is an existent thing arising. That is exactly Nagarjuna's point of view. And in fact, if you go through the Mula Madhyamaka Karika, you go through all of Nagarjuna's work, that is exactly what he's saying, is that to assert that anything exists is to fall into what are called the two extreme views. Which brings me back to the sutra. So, the third paragraph, all exists, kaccānagotta. This is one extreme. All does not exist. This is the second extreme. Without veering towards either of these extremes, the Tathagata teaches the Dharma of the middle, or Kaccānagotta. One extreme view is to say that everything exists, and the second extreme is to deny that anything exists. The Tathagata has pointed out a foundation in the middle, which avoids both extremes. So, again, today, I know it might be like, wait, did we talk about that? But today the goal has been to explain why we think or how it is we think in terms of existence and non-existence, and to complicate that and realize that those ideas are rather specious at best, which is the idea that they are really dependent upon each other. And I don't want anybody, of course, to just say, well, if the Buddha said that's true, or if Michael said it's true, then nothing must exist or not exist. I want you to understand how it is that the imputing of existence is like an idea in that way. Like the putting on of existence of things is an idea based upon the presumption of their non-existence. And again, what we talked about is that if you are presuming the existence of something, you are simultaneously presuming it's not existent. At the same time, it's the only way you arrive at existence. And again, I made that statement that if there wasn't such a thing as non-existent, we wouldn't need to talk about existence in that way. So there are already mutually arising in that sense. Now, one of the things I want to point out before it's too late is that this is the philosopher Nagarjuna's magnum opus. This is his major work. It's called The Fundamental Wisdom of the Middle Way, the Middle Path, the Madhyamaka, if you've heard of that term. Nagarjuna's teachings and his school of thought is called the Madhyamaka, the Middle Way. And this is a rather dense treatise, I will say, but if you have a copy or you cruise over to chapter 15, which is an examination of bhava, an examination of essence, an examination of this idea of the essential nature of something. And what he says, and I will just give you the bullet point here. In verse 7, actually, in verse 6, he says, those who see essence and essential difference and entities and non-entities, they do not see the truth taught by the Buddha. The victorious one, the Buddha, through knowledge of reality and unreality, in the discourse on Katyayana, refuted both it is and it is not. So, just to give you that. Now, one of the things that happens in the Mulamadhyamaka Karika and that happens with Nagarjuna's thought is that he bases almost his entire philosophy, his entire teaching on what is known as the 12-link chain of dependent origination. At the very end of this sutra, when it says, with ignorance as condition, samskara, habits, conditioning, otherwise known as volitional formations, come to be. With volitional formations as a condition, consciousness comes to be. And then we get some ellipses, dot, dot, dot. Mm-hmm. And that's where, if you don't know about the 12-link chain of causation, you are left to wonder, well, what more is there than consciousness? So on our sheet, I have put for our third part, I put all 12 links, and you need to know that in the sutra, where it trails off in ellipses, you should be filling in the blanks of the other, 9 links in the chain in that way. So for the conclusion of this session and kind of to bring the sutra to a close, let's have a quick conversation about, let's just have a quick 15-minute conversation about dependent origination and the 12-link chain of causation. So the first thing you need to know, of course, is that the 12-link chain of causation is an essential early Buddhist teaching. There are many a sutra about it. You should know that in earlier versions of the 12-link chain, or in earlier versions of this idea, there's only 10 links in the chain of causation. And in other versions, there's sometimes 16, 18, 20 links. So these are like what became codified as the 12 links, but I don't want us to forget that this could be a shorter list or it could be expanded upon. All right, so that's the first thing. So there's nothing particularly magical or authoritative about these 12. It's just what everybody came to understand. And what it is it's a way of understanding the world, where the world comes from. And what ultimately Nagarjuna's position is, and I am going to kind of paraphrase this, the idea is this. So let me put it to you this way then. New idea. What causes a car to go? Is it gasoline? What if I had all the gas in the world, but I didn't have an engine? What if I had all the gas in the world and an engine, but no tires? What is it that causes a car to go? Can you really actually put your finger on a cause? Right? No. In fact, reducing causation to singular causes is delusional. It's just not looking carefully enough. So one of the things that I kind of would like to point out is this. There's a certain way of thinking. We've already talked about it a number of times, but I didn't put it to you this way. It's the idea that um, it's so we have this idea of singular causes, which is that this caused that. Okay, then what caused that? Right? So if this was the cause of that, what caused that then?
Oh,
that. What caused that? That. What caused that? That. And it keeps going and it keeps going and it keeps going. And what I find very interesting is that you may or may not be aware that Aristotle in, I think it's either the Physics or the Metaphysics, but in one of them, he famously draws this conclusion of what he refers to as the prime mover, which will eventually become in Neoplatonic Christian theology, an understanding of the creation of the world by God. And that's what Aristotle asserted, that there was this prime mover. But where do you get the idea of the prime mover? You get the idea of the prime mover because you think that this was caused by that, and now you're asking the question, what caused that? And the logical conclusion is to take a step back and go, well, that caused it. What caused that? And eventually you have to get at the prime mover, that which has not been caused, but causes. And of course, Jimmy's laughing because nobody has ever been back there to see that. It is a logical deduction, because that's exactly what Aristotle is in the business of doing, is logical deductions. So the presumption, not the knowing, but the presumption of a prime mover is a logical conclusion. To say then that God is the prime mover, not caused, but causal, is exactly the same idea. And again, I want us to notice that there's a way that you can arrive at that kind of thinking. But guess what? After, you know, Nietzsche famously declared the death of God and all of that, you know what we came up with? Well, the singularity. Well, if there was this, then there's that, then there's that, then it has to go back to that single point of energy because that's the original cause. Ah, we found it again, the original cause. And all we've done actually is find a conclusion to our logical thinking. We've not proven, discovered anything. Check this out though. I want you to notice that that way of thinking, what I like to just simply call the one-to-one causation. My example of the car is to point out that there is not a singular cause. It is a confluence of causes and conditions. That is the Buddhist language, and I use the car as a good example of that. There's not one cause, there's a confluence. And if you don't have tires, and you don't have gas, and you don't have an engine, and you don't have that, spark plugs, you need all of them in order for there to be, quote, a car. But there's not one cause. But we do think in terms of one-to-one causation. It's actually a faulty way of thinking in that sense. Again, you could arrive at the idea of the Big Bang or God or the prime mover, take your pick. But the idea is we do that exact same way of thinking in terms of what caused that? Well, this caused that, but then what caused that? And the buck stops here. So we do the same kind of logical thinking of one-to-one causation, and we stop here, and that's what we think of as free will and agency, is the idea that there is no prior cause. There is just me causing. But of course, anybody with a brain knows that we don't just do things. We are prodded and pushed by the world to do things in that way. But what I want us to notice is that there is the fabrication of the buck stops here. And that is also a contributing factor to the delusion of self, which is that I caused that to ring. Did I cause that to ring?
the hierarchy of causality.
It was a confluence of causes and conditions.
Are the actor here, you know?
To say that I caused that bell to ring is like saying it was the gasoline that caused the car. Whereas it was a confluence of phenomena that all had to be just right. All the things had to be appropriate in order for the bell to ring. So that is a rather complicated introduction to this idea that we have the notion of one-to-one causation, but in reality, it is a confluence of causes and conditions. Now, if we look at this 12-link chain of causation, these are the gasoline, the wheels, the engine, the spark plugs, and all of the different parts that go to the fabrication in that sense of the world. And there is not a cause of the world back there that leads to the world arising and therefore existing. And there is not a cause of the world going out of existing and therefore then not existing. There is the present arising of a world based upon there being ignorance, conditioning, a conscious mind there to experience it, but a language structure, which is what nama rupa is. Nama rupa is language. So consciousness playing the language game that is dividing reality into six different kinds of sense media, by which I come into contact with the world, having a sensation of something that is desirable to crave. I know that was very fast, but did everybody follow what I was doing there? I was moving us up the 12-link chain of causation, beginning with ignorance, that we don't really know what's going on here. We're thinking in terms of existence and non-existence. We're thinking in terms of one-to-one causation. We're all turned upside down. We keep doing that. That's called conditioning, which is that I keep thinking in terms of existence and non-existence. So from our ignorance comes our conditioning, and behold, a conscious state arising out of that, and then playing the language game by which I divide the world into eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and visuals and auditory sounds, by which there is now contact and then having a sensation and then clinging to that sensation. And guess what? After all of that, in a sense, there is now an object, bhava, the bowl. And now that we've got something, now we can talk about where it came from and where it's going. Birth and death. What I want you to notice, and Tanya had a comment earlier that alluded to this, in terms of the 12-link chain of causation, there's a way in which we think that there was birth, bhava, meaning existence, and then death. This is suggesting actually that these 12 co-arise and that at any point there is anything going on, all 12 of these are at play. And it's just like a car where all of these are the component parts to make a world go round. And it's not that any one of them is the cause, and there is certainly not a cause way back there in time. And we could at that point, which we don't have time for, but we could get deeper into how then the constructions of notions of time are rather arbitrary and dependent upon each other, which is that what exactly is the past? Like, how big is the past? Does it like keep getting bigger with like every second that passes? Does the past just keep getting bigger and bigger? How about the future? How big is the future, right? So our ideas about the past and the future are predicated on what we think of as happening now. But how do you come to this idea of now? Because you have those ideas of before and after. So now is an idea that is poised precariously between now and then, before and after. But you can't have ideas of before and after until you have already established the now. And again, does the past just keep getting bigger and bigger? How about the future? Does it keep getting less and less and less? The ideas are ridiculous. And that's sort of what today has been about, is about looking at the way we think and noticing that it is, and let's go back to the beginning of the sutra, right? Katyayana. This world, for the most part, depends upon a duality, upon the notion of existence and the notion of non-existence. Questions, comments, answers, ideas?
In the transcript, the dot, dot, dot in the transcript that I have, which is well done, thank you. Absolutely, nothing exists. Avoid the extremes, teaches by the way of the middle, ignorance, not knowing the truth of the way things are, is the condition of mental fabrication, condition of self-consciousness, condition name of form, everything you just
said. Oh, cool.
The six spheres, contact, feelings, conditioned cravings, craving, conditioned clinging, the conditions of birth, the condition of aging, death, sorrow, lamentation, distress, and despair. This is how the entire mass of suffering arises. Then, but the complete fading away, cessation, is that very ignorance, that mental fabrication ceases. The next one ceases. It's not, they don't know. They don't know. Just let go. And it ends with birth ceases, aging, death, and sorrow, lamentation, distress, despair ceases. That is how this entire mass of suffering. Touch the ground.
Questions, comments, answers, ideas.
So, I want to see if I get this. So, the first paragraph, we're talking about the existence and the non-existence as the two extremes, the dual extremes, are both the right way, or what do we call it? The correct vision.
The right view.
Right view. Recognizes that existence, both existence and non-existence, are subject to the 12-link chain. And that's why that's very valid. Is that right?
Yeah. So I'm going to back up again. I might answer your question roundabout. So one of the things that I did want to stress was this, the sutra kind of makes clear that to see or understand this dependent origination, this 12-link chain of dependent origination, is effectively right view. So to see the world in terms of that, what we are being told though, is that to see the world in terms of existence and non-existence is the wrong view. Right. So the 12-link chain at the end is being given to us as the middle path between those ideas. And what is being suggested in that 12-link chain is like, take for example, let's just take birth. So when we come into this, hypothetically, when we came into this morning, we had a very, very clear notion that I existed. And therefore, I have that notion that I was born. And of course, I have that notion that I will die. And what this is suggesting is that there's another way to look at that, which is not that the birth down that way caused the this here now, and that this here now is going to cause the death down there. What it is, it's about understanding that you will never, ever, ever be able to talk about or think about birth without also thinking of death. It's a package deal. And what we're getting at, and this is where these ideas are so tricky to articulate. What it is that if you hear these ideas of no self, if you hear, say, the idea of emptiness, it's very, very quick to then say, oh, then birth doesn't exist. But that's falling into an extreme view of non-existence, that there's no such thing as birth. Oh, so there is birth. No, why do you keep falling into extreme views? That's an extreme view. Rather, there is this co-arising of birth and death, and that any time a mind is thinking in terms of birthness, birthnessity, you will automatically be thinking in terms of deathnessity. And that is the idea. Oh, and by the way, those two ideas are predicated on this idea of the bhava, which is that there is something there to begin with, which means anytime you're thinking in terms of birth or death, you're thinking that there must be something there that was born and will die. And if you're thinking that way, then you're clinging to something by default in that way, because you're clinging to the thing that was born and that will die. And we could go back around the 12-link chain, but I think you're starting to see what I mean, that it's like a package deal of all 12 of those. And the Buddha is suggesting, again, this is where it gets really tricky, because we don't want to be rash and throw it all out, but we don't want to be rash and just be like, no, I was born, I exist. We're trying to understand this much more delicate middle path where we understand what birth is, which is that it's the opposite of death. Well, what's death? The opposite of birth. And so those two are in this binary relationship. And so I haven't stressed this enough today. It's too late to really get into this, but we really kind of at that point need to start recognizing all of this as concepts and realizing that the concept of birth is resting on the concept of death, which is resting on the concept of there being something there that it will be born and was died, which is resting on there being a appropriating subject, grabbing that thing that they want. And again, we could go back around, but that idea that there's implications to all of these dharmas, in that sense, as concepts. And it, again, I keep using this language, it's a package deal and you get them all at once. And that is the actual arising of the world and the actual cessation of the world. And by cessation, and let me make this clear, when he talks at the end about, and that's the total cessation of suffering, the total cessation of this mass of suffering, it's about this idea of identifying as a birth / mortal being in that way, and understanding why we would do that. Why would we identify as a mortal being? Because of this package deal of, well, I exist, ergo I will not exist, and, you know, go back to 1 o'clock. And that's where we started. Please.
What is name form?
Nama Rupa. So this is a great example of what is called name and form. Nama Rupa. A bowl. Is that it's what we call it, or is that what it's shaped like? Oh, it's the same thing. That there is this intimate relationship between the names for things and then the form that they take in that way. And it's basically the way language works in that sense. And what it is this. So does anybody know what you call, and let's just play along, a bowl? Does anybody know what you call a bowl in Spanish or a different language? Nobody?
Plato.
What is it?
Plato.
All right, we could do plate or, yeah. So my point is, or it's easier with a tangible object, but if you kind of go like, so there is hello, konnichiwa, hola, guten tag, right? All these different ways of saying what?
Hello?
Oh, no, hello is one of the ways to say what?
Greeting.
And you, that's a word. That's the greeting. So, but to say what? And you realize that you can't think outside of language.
Yeah, without the word, it's not there. It's not a thing.
That's nama rupa. No word, no thing.
numbers?
Oh, sure. Oh, absolutely.
Oh, actually, wait a minute, wait a minute. It's a thing. It's just not conceived of a thing.
What? Una cosa? Like what thing? What? So what are we referring to? And again, what we realize is that there's no way out of language.
It's an unnameable object that exists. But it has, there's this inherent quality of the thing that is not separate from anything else. But it is nonetheless a thing. Well, we just don't have. There's just no way to call it. So
that's hello. That's the true nature of hello.
Thing.
Yeah. If you try to do it without words, like even if you do it
mentally,
no,
right. It's a concept.
But you realize that you keep falling back on a word, and that if you don't have that word. You don't have that thing. You know, there's a really classic study about this. And by the way, I don't want to keep anybody too long. There's a really classic study about this where they had a color wheel of various shades of red. In English, we have the word pink. And that color wheel, one of the, like, I don't know how many, you know, slices of the color pie there were. They were all shades of red, but there was one that for an English speaker was obviously pink. They took the same color wheel to a culture where they don't have a word for pink, and that culture could not identify which was the non, like it was all the same color. At least that's what the study showed. And the idea was is that without the prior word for the form, you actually don't even see it.
Oh.
That's what we're talking about. That without the construct of language, we actually don't even know, can't experience in that way.
You don't have the category.
Bingo. That's Nama Rupa. It's a really interesting idea all by itself. Yeah, Tanya.
I'm just getting back to the text here. So it says at the very end, it's talking about the 12-link chain. And it says that the 12-link chain basically, such as the origin of the math, the whole mass of suffering, it's the 12-link chain.
The 12-link chain is the mass of suffering.
Right, and so, which is, because you were saying it's like the middle between existence and non-existence, but I'm a little, I get what you're saying about the confluence of everything, there's no one-to-one, right, and mm-hmm. with the 12-link chain, they're all rising at once, and it's like a Jenga tower, like you pull one out, and it's all gone, right? So if you want to see suffering, then you got to pull out.
Yep.
At least you got to get into the 12-link chain.
Yep.
And somehow see through that particular part of it, and then that will make the whole thing collapse, and then you're not suffering anymore.
Yep. And what would that mean to pull that Jenga piece out?
So you see that. It doesn't have inherent existence. It that particular agenda piece, it's all dependently arising. And I guess if you can, I'm battling here, but mm-hmm. It would be to be in that flow state where you aren't othering, or again, like there's no me or you, right? There's just what's happening, phenomena. I don't know if that's accurate.
Mm-hmm. So in regards to Tanya's beautiful analogy of a Jenga, a 12-piece Jenga set, indeed, we take any one of these 12 pieces out and the whole house of cards falls apart. And I asked, what would it mean to pull out one of those pieces? You answered correctly. I just want to reiterate what you said. What we want to do is to pull out one of those pieces would be to, let's take Bhava, which again is about existence, things existing. And what we've already talked about is this duality of existing or not existing. And the middle path of not claiming that phenomena exist, but also that they don't exist, right? That would take out that Jenga piece of Bhava. And now you don't have birth because there's nothing to be born. You don't have death because there's nothing to die. This is what I was talking about earlier about we can cling to the childhood, and that means we're going to cling to that, and then we're clinging to this, and now you get the whole world arising. But to pull out that Jenga piece to be like, oh, I wasn't born. And that's why Buddhism is called the teaching of the deathless. It's not a teaching of immortality. It's a teaching of deathlessness, which is that actually you in that sense, the true you, the enlightened mind in that sense, was not born, does not die, does not come, does not go, is Buddha nature, is the short answer in that way. Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Really interesting. Thank you. My experience with Buddhism is that a lot of the ways that eliminates pain are like a semantic sleight of hand where it doesn't really eliminate the phenomenological pain of like I hear what you're saying, because of this continuity of self on like, I was a kid once, I had so much energy, I don't now, I'm sad. Like you're saying that's fictive in a sense, and that like, you know, if you take this view of like interdependent origination, like birth and death are also concepts you don't get, but how do I address the actual pain of my actual existence and the fact that I will die, and there's a phenomenological aggregate associated with that? Like, to me, this seems very much like a linguistic game.
Yeah, and my quick short answer, because we are quite over time, my quick short answer is actually, yes, it's this semantic game that's causing us a lot of mental anguish. That's the idea, is that we're playing this semantic game, but then I would want to draw your attention back to the key language of the kind of ideas of clinging and attachment. And the idea is that we are clinging and attached to semantical structures, but we forget we're doing that. And we think we're clinging to actual things and that there's actually something at stake. So you are right about the semantics, but it's about actually realizing, oh yeah, those semantics are causing me a lot of, and they're also causing a lot of contention and fighting in the world and all kinds of strife. And it's about kind of meditating, not blindly accepting, but just meditating on, oh yeah, what if everybody didn't take all of this quite so seriously in that way? What would that be like? It'd probably be a lot chiller. In that sense. And then you realize, oh, everybody's so uptight and antagonistic because of the clinging and attachment. That's what the Buddha realized. Like, everybody's all worked up about what they're clinging and attached to. So. All right. Well, thank you so much.